So good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Thursday, April 21st meeting of the Plympton Board of Selectmen. Just a reminder that this meeting is being recorded for cablecast and YouTube presentation by Area 58 Community Access Media. The video of this meeting is not to be considered an official public record. I think we'll dispense with ground rules because I think we've all heard them enough. And so what we'll do is just go to a few moments of silence for whatever purpose, to collect thoughts, to maybe find a deep center from which our discussion can happen tonight, maybe to just enjoy a few minutes of silence. Okay, welcome everyone. So the agenda has been published. Are there any additional agenda items that anyone would like considered tonight? All right, so first thing to do, I think, is a brief discussion with my fellow selectmen. We originally scheduled this meeting mainly as sort of a safety net if we needed it to work on warrant articles, because the warrant will be finished next Monday night. We did it understanding that there is a meeting in Kingston tonight about the Silver Lake land sale. We end up with quite a few items on our agenda, and some of them could take some time. I did go ahead and list some of the agenda items also for Monday night. I guess the point being, we have a choice. We can actually try to get through by 6:15 so that those of us that want to go to Kingston can, or we can simply work our way through the agenda so that we'll have a little bit less next Monday to deal with. Any preference on that?
I wasn't planning on going to that meeting. Okay. So I think if you're planning on going there. And
I am not.
Christine, were you planning on going?
I was planning on going, but I think this is more important and I can catch up with that anytime. So why don't we just wrap her up.
All right. Well, let's see what we can do. We'll dive in and see what happens. So the first item was intended to be a meeting with the fire chief, but as he is not here, we'll go further down. I will say we do have on the agenda the Maple Street driveway width issue. Several neighbors had asked for time with us, and that is expected to happen at 6 p.m. I did invite the zoning enforcement officer, the fire chief, and the neighbors. And Dale, in Bree's absence, will you be willing?
Taking minutes, I know. You didn't even really have to ask for that.
No worries. Here's the start.
Huh?
Here's the start.
Oh, I just need the time.
So I guess we might as well go in order. First agenda item reads as clarify instructions to town council regarding draft community host agreement with marijuana grow facility and a draft letter of support of non-opposition. I think I will start off that discussion. It's a little hard even to know where to start, but I'm going to give myself permission to just ramble on for a few minutes in the hopes we can begin to figure out how to move forward a little. So I may well ramble. There will be the opportunity for my fellow selectmen. I hope we, the three of us, have the opportunity tonight to talk a little bit. Because of open meeting law, we never have the chance to really talk amongst ourselves except on camera. I think we have a pretty big problem developing in town, and I think the problem has become much bigger than this particular issue. and the well-being of town governments in general is beginning to be a real concern for me. So we will stick to the agenda item, but hopefully in service of trying to get somewhere on this. So first of all, a little preamble. I have felt like I've had a good relationship with Christine to my right over the year. I've actually really enjoyed working with her and working together. I think there have been times we've disagreed on some things, but we've done a pretty good job of finding common ground. I really hate that she and I are so far apart on this, and I've expressed that before, and I'll just leave it at that. I hate it that it's that way, but it is. So I think sometimes in adversity, our true colors come out, and I think we all want to be careful of that. I think we all, on any side of this issue, or anyone even trying to deal with this issue, is facing a lot of adversity, and hopefully, for all of us, our true colors can come out. All right. Having said all that, I am going to give myself permission to be playful for just a minute or two. I know time is important. I know we always ask people to be concise in their thoughts. But I'm going to take a few minutes. Maybe this is the trade for the hundreds or the thousands of unpaid hours I've put in sitting up here for a while. So last week, a Freedom of Information Records request was filed with the town clerk by people, someone opposed to the marijuana grow facility. It asked me to turn over all of my records related to the grow facility. It asked me to turn over anything that I had in my communications that had the words marijuana, cannabis, and another spelling of marijuana for the last 18 months. I did so. I did so within a couple of days, because I think maybe in asking for anyone can, of course, ask for a records request. They are done. It is a right of citizens, but I thought maybe there was the implication in asking for that there had been some foul play going along. So I was thrilled to turn over 250 emails and my a bunch of personal notes that I take at this meeting. I hope as people read that, they will notice that there is nothing there of any kind in terms of conflict of interest, in terms of open meeting law violations, in terms of anything but integrity in trying to deal with a difficult issue. However, that didn't have anything in it. So, obviously, those records didn't have everything in it about me. So, a few more things. I'm 67 and a half years old. I've lived in Plympton for 14 years. I've loved Plympton all my life. I've been treating Plympton pets for 43 years. I am a radical moderate. If there was still such a thing, I'd be a Rockefeller Republican, or if you're old enough to remember, a Yankee Republican. I believe government should stay out of people's lives as much as possible. When it is needed in people's lives, I believe it should be careful and fair and as fair as possible. I believe in being really frugal with people's tax dollars, especially the local tax dollars. I believe in diversity and inclusiveness. I believe in transparency, courtesy, civility, thoughtfulness, and fairness. I was arrested for protesting an unfair war, an unjust war. I greatly admire public service in all of its forms, military, government, private, volunteer, church. I smoked a lot of pot when I was a kid. I haven't touched the stuff in 30 years. I was addicted to nicotine for 20 years. I am against the legalization of marijuana. I'm probably for the decriminalization of it. I abhor the overuse of recreational drugs. I especially abhor the overuse or much of any of use in young children's brains. I am an avid advocate of open space, parks, small farms, the rural nature of small towns, and I'm an avid advocate of thoughtful, sane economic development. And I believe those two things are not mutually exclusive. I do not believe in scorched earth tactics at any cost to get one's way. I do believe the larger good must be kept in mind. I do a lot of work for nonprofit organizations, leading the board of directors of various organizations. They generally are slightly dysfunctional and not very profitable. My shirt size is 15½, 32. My suit size is 38 short. My pant size is 32-29. And once again, I believe in transparency, courtesy, civility, thoughtfulness, fairness, and working creatively in town government. Okay. So that was meant to be a little playful. There may have been a little message in there as well. That's that. Now where? I think the bottom line is I need some time with town council, and what's going to come out of some of our discussion tonight is asking for some time with town council. I would like to get some clarification on if the Board of Selectmen decided to write a letter of support or non-opposition, what it might look like. Not to sign that letter at any point. Town Council advised us a while back, there is some language that the state suggests or seems to require if we were to go ahead with support or non-opposition. Town Council advised us that we could change that language. And if so, well, one of the things I'd like to do with Town Council is confirm that that is her recommendation. And I would be interested in seeing what that language might look like. I'm not sure. I don't think I could support the language as the state suggested. So I'm interested in seeing if I can support the other language. Maybe not. And if not, then maybe most of this discussion is done. So that's thing one. Thing number two, we have been given a draft community host agreement written by the attorney for the GROW facility. It's a pretty darn good document. It has some really substantial financial rewards to the town. I think it does a lot of things to take care of a lot of the concerns. I wonder what additional things could be done. I think to make a decision on one whether one is in favor or against the GROW facility probably ought to be based on what a community host agreement's going to look like. I've said all along myself that I could potentially be in favor of a GROW facility if an appropriate municipal host agreement could be done. Thirdly, the thing I'd like to check with Town Council on, there are three citizens' petitions that will be before town meeting. We have not had the opportunity yet to talk to Town Council to better understand. She has let us know that one of them would be merely advisory. Mm-hmm. There are two other ones that I have no idea what the implications for those are. So really, those are the three things that I hope to Town Council to go to Town Council to get a better idea on. To be quite clear, I think the decision between this, and I'm just going to say things as they are and continue to just be transparent on this. We have a decision to make on whether we might vote on this before town meeting or not. And I think we need that additional information from Town Council. I feel like I need it to be able to make that decision. In and of itself, I think this decision is a really important one. I well understand there are people that have really strong objections to this. I well understand some fear. I well understand the concern. I ache for people that are fearful about this. After wrestling with this for weeks and months, I think most of the concerns that have been put forth can be taken care of. I think there is, in the interest of the town, two important things. At this point, we have an offer of the financial reward to the town of $100,000 a year. Over 20 years, that's $2 million. So I well understand there are people that are against this GROW facility. I well understand there are people for it. I think we need to be careful to remember that if we don't go ahead with this, we are quite possibly losing the opportunity at $2 million. This is no small decision in a town where very frequently the number one concern that's brought to selectmen, that's brought to town government is the tax rate and what a burden it is. On a slightly bigger level, and I'm winding down and will shut up in a couple of moments, I am very concerned in general about town governance through citizen petition. Citizens certainly have the right to put citizen petitions on the town meeting warrant, and we are obligated to do it. If we have 10 citizen petitions on the warrant this year, two of them I will have to recuse myself from. I am very concerned of the chaos that could come out of long-range governance in this town if we try to run the town by citizen petition. Moreover, I think we have to be very, very careful about the ramifications of single issue decisions. I've heard scuttlebutt or some rumors about potential recall votes based on this single issue. Even aside from this issue, even aside from how the amount of money involved and the discord in this town, I think we have to be very, very careful to look at the long-range implications of any of our decisions. So, I think I've said enough. I would be very interested in hearing from my fellow selectmen. I think the three of us are under a big obligation of somehow bringing this to some creative conclusion or somehow moving the process on before the whole town gets ripped apart.
Okay. First, about the letter of support or non-opposition. I did speak with the attorney at the Department of Health, who is in charge of the marijuana program. And she told me that the language that the state provided does have to be in there. However, we are able to or allowed to make any qualifications that we'd like to. We can write our own letter, you know, beyond what that says. So that's that. I've spent a lot of today very angry, and it's not really something I'm given to. It's not something I enjoy. I don't understand how people think they know my mind when I don't know my mind. I want this process to play out. I want to know that the zoning is acceptable. If the zoning is not acceptable, we don't have an issue. If it is acceptable, then we have to make a decision. I think it would be imprudent of us to not move forward on developing and negotiating a contract. That doesn't mean we have to sign it. That doesn't mean we have to write a letter of support. But in any business deal you're doing, you communicate. And you think, well, this is what will happen if I do this, and this is what will happen if I do that. But you don't just sit and wait for everything to fall on you. So I think it's prudent of us to develop a host agreement. And I don't think it's prudent. I wouldn't be willing to make a decision right now on the letter. I would like to see you know, what we come up with a host agreement. I would like to see what's happening in the legislature. I think that there are a lot of people that are against this. I also know that there are a lot of people that are for it. You just happen to be a lot more vocal. I mean, if you look at the letters we've gotten, if I think about all the people that I talk to, there are a lot of people that are in favor of this. Additionally, there are a lot of people that don't care. You know, this is a small group on either side, really. And I'm willing to take some time to let it develop. And I think that any rift that has come in this town has really been, and I'm sorry to say this, it's really been on the side of, or has been caused by some of the people, not all of the people, but some of the people that are opposed to it.
You can't be serious when you say that.
Excuse me. We're going to let the selectmen speak at this point. Everyone's had a lot of time along the way, but we're going to continue to have our conversation here right now. I'm sorry.
I'm not saying that the initial idea didn't start it. Obviously, that's the case. But taking this to a personal level, to me, that's what's caused the rift. It's driving it down to base human thoughts and actions, and that's, if you haven't seen all the emails that we've gotten, and there are personal remarks that are not kind. So
you haven't seen our emails either, or phone calls.
This is not a debate at this point. This, for the moment, is a discussion amongst the three selectmen.
And there was an email that said that I have an agenda and said that I'm self-serving. And frankly, I can't see how anything in this project is self-serving to me or that I have an agenda. My agenda is to hear both sides and to make a decision based on what I think is best for the town. It may not be what you think is best for the town, but it may be what that person thinks is best for the town. And that's all I have to say.
I'm glad that you guys both have, you know, shared your thoughts on this. I'm happy that you've done that. My issue is that I just legally don't think it's allowed. And I think it's black and white. And it is allowed, but it's in the business district. So, you know, why, instead of continuing to fight for something that we've been told is not legal, look, the way to make it work would be to put it where it is allowed by the bylaws. I think that would be a creative option for Mr. Randall to proceed, is to put it where it's allowed, not where we have been told by three attorneys, not ours, who says it's not clear, you know, where it's not allowed. So I think in that respect, the zoning is black and white. And while we continue to talk about putting it where we've been told it's not allowed by high-ranking attorneys, that's why I've been completely inflexible. Yeah. That's all I got.
I get it. Here's the problem. I think we've been told it's not allowed by some attorneys or legal authorities. We have been told by town council that she thinks it's allowed. We've been told by others they think it may be allowed. I think it is absolutely unthinkable to say it is not allowed when there are clearly gray areas. I mean, we are certainly in a situation where various legal authorities have told us different things. And quite honestly, my very simplistic but simple, clear reading of the bylaws imply to me that it is allowed. The applicant has stipulated that if the legislature passes the legislation, they will withdraw their effort on this. And it makes total sense to me in the meantime to be moving forward and seeing what happens.
If it were so clear, I don't know why there would be even any debate or need for the legislature to take any time over. They would just say, well, this is clear, and we'll clarify it and codify it, and boom, we're done.
But well, I think out of respect for Jeff's position, they're really taking a look at it. He asked them to not to fast-track it, and they listened. And I think that they valued what people said to them. He had a couple of people that were there supporting his position, and I think they wanted to take it all in, and they don't want to rush to make a decision. But what we were told was that it didn't need to be clarified or codified, that it already is illegal. According to even what we got from Kay Doyle, she said that says the dispensary is in compliance with the Humanitarian Medical Use of Marijuana Act, Chapter 369. The act clearly defines marijuana it has the given meaning of under Chapter 94C of the general laws, which is the controlled substance. And then in 94C, it goes on to talk about the manufacture, which is the production, preparation, propagation, compounding, conversion, or processing of a controlled substance, either directly or indirectly, by extraction from substances of natural origin. So, you know, it. I think that it is clear that it's 94C, that it's under that chapter that is guiding this law, which created the whole program. So I think that they have defined it. And it's considered manufacture, not agriculture, not growing.
And I think we could debate this forever.
We
know there are different opinions. Maybe this is too simplistic. I feel like putting a seed in ground, giving it some fresh air and light, and it growing into a plant sounds a whole bunch like agriculture to me. And all the rest of it is a lot of lawyers arguing back and forth. And how that turns out, I don't know. On a simplistic level, which I think is one approach, not the only approach, to judging this, you could make a pretty strong case that growing this plant is agriculture. Once again, town council, who's the direct one to direct us, has told us that she thinks this is allowable.
Is agriculture.
Is allowable. So... so we're on the horns of a dilemma. I mean, there is a part of me that would almost, that would love to just drop this and be past this for everyone's sake, especially for this board's sake, so that we can get on with the much more important work to do. We've spent vast quantities of time on it. We've spent vast quantities of emotional energy on it. At the same time, I think to not give the applicant his due, to risk a $2 million benefit to the town, and frankly, to give in to some strong criticism, but loud criticism that has drowned out those in favor of it, I think would be a mistake as well. In any event, I'm not quite sure where we go next. I think what I'd like to do next, to just keep plodding along as best we can, is to ask for a bit of time with town council to explore what improving the... well, to explore once more the zoning issue, to explore once more what language we could add to a support letter, and to explore what is involved and what would come out of or wouldn't come out of the town meeting warrant articles, to simply have more information, all that, and hopefully to get that and present that Monday night.
All right, so you want to talk to her about, you said clarification, confirm her clarification. What was that about?
First is clarification on instructions to town council.
Oh, that's right. Well, clarification of what has to be included in the letter. Is that what you were going to ask her about, too?
Yeah. I really clarification on the process from her perspective.
Okay.
Moving forward on how... and frankly, straight out, for her advice as town council, who deals with this kind of divisive issue, who deals in a big way with the process of town government, I really just like to ask her advice on the whole thing. But in particular, advice on moving forward with a community host agreement, advice on what might be involved in creating a letter of support or non-opposition. That's not to sign it or vote on it, but to know what would be involved, advice on where she thinks we're at with zoning, and especially advice if we get to town meeting with this unresolved on what the implications of passage or failure of passage of the warrant articles would be.
Why wouldn't you want to wait? where we've gotten so much input from people on both sides of this issue to let the town decide. Let people show up for town meeting and let the town decide.
I have wrestled with that one, and I continue to wrestle with it. The state gave the authority to boards of selectmen, mayors, city councils to do this, not to town meeting. In their wisdom or lack thereof, that was their recommendation. I am concerned about the long-term implications of and even sort of the constitutional issues that will come up if we start ceding the authority giving to us to others. That's issue number one. Issue number two, look, if everyone in town, if everyone came to town meeting and voted, I think maybe we would get good sort of advice. I am very concerned with turnout and with really hot issues, that those on one side are much more motivated than those on the other side. I am not so sure that we get any clearer message at town meeting. And the third reason to potentially not wait for town meeting is to just get this over with. I think if we don't, this will drag on forever, and we may have a town that just gets torn apart with this. And I think one way to get past it is to get past it. Quite honestly, I think all the time of Joe Freitas, who sat up there here for 38 years, and he and I could argue about almost anything, but I feel like I almost owe an apology to this town, in that maybe I should have done what Joe would have done weeks ago, which is call for a vote and be done with it. And you know, Joe would have said, damn it, we're just doing it, or we're not doing it. And that, as much as I disagreed with that, as much as I believe in process and deep listening, we're in a mess here.
Yeah, we absolutely are. You're right.
And so that's one reason that just going ahead and voting on it, I mean, it'll still be going on afterward, but at least that's there.
Well, it hasn't been done all that often. We did it with the water. So it's not something that every time there's something controversial, because there's been things in between. So when something is very polarizing, though, you know, there would be a reason to let people decide and let the town decide what's which way they want to go. So it's not something that happens all the time.
Here's the thing. They're not deciding. They're simply advising
us. Well,
you're
right.
This is non-binding.
You're right. They're just advising. But it would be a way for us to see. And, you know, I just basically see one side of it. It would probably be enlightening to me to see how many people support it.
I'm just curious, if 200 voted against it and 203 voted for it, you would be willing to go with that majority of three?
Yes, because I think it's illegal already. But, yeah, I mean, majority, simple majority. That's generally, I mean, that's the simplest form of government, is for people to. One vote per person. Yes, no.
It is the simplest form of government, and there are times that there are really complex issues that we volunteer our time to delve into and fully understand. And there are a lot of people that come to town meeting that are very concerned about this town and just don't have time to delve into all that. And then we get to the place that good oratory sometimes isn't necessarily, it can be very persuasive, but not necessarily the wisest. And I'm just trying to be careful on all that. All right.
I forgot. I was going to say something else, but I forgot.
I think Dale knows the answer, but he's just not telling us yet.
I would prefer that, you know, we work on the hosting agreement. I really don't want Alana working with Jeff's attorney to work this out. I think that this is something we need to work out ourselves, and then, you know, it could go to the attorneys, but I would prefer that, you know, this is something that we do. I really don't want the attorneys working out the terms of the hosting agreement. This is, I think, something that we need to do first.
I'm assuming you mean that you want us to negotiate the terms.
Yes.
And then it goes back to the attorneys.
Yes, then it goes back to the attorneys to, you know, tweak any language. But I would prefer that, you know, we do this rather than having the attorneys do it. I just think that would be more appropriate. I'd feel more comfortable with that.
Certainly moving ahead in some form on the host agreement. If we get to town meeting to vote on this, I think we should know, and the town should know what we're looking at.
Mm-hmm.
If we are going to work on that, do we do that in executive session?
No.
Okay, good. It cannot go on the agenda for next Monday. I guess we could put
it. Why not?
Because it's already been filed.
Yeah, but you've got clarify instructions to town council okay. regarding draft community. I mean, it's
all
on
right,
there,
so
but not.
I think we could begin. All right, I think we could discuss it, and I would be glad.
I'm okay with that. Mm-hmm. I think that's
okay.
I think if we can get through some of the stuff and not have to pay town council, then
yeah, I mean, that just makes more sense. I mean, we're the ones that know what the issues are, not them, and I think that okay. that's something that we could do.
Then will each of us have time? It's Thursday night between now and Monday to
mm-hmm.
get together some first ideas. I am excited about building in the safeguards. A lot of this, there are a lot of safeguards in there already. I'm actually impressed with the document in terms of safeguards. I think we can build in more, and I'd like to see where we get to. So we will discuss that in open meeting Monday night.
Mm-hmm.
I would still like to make a motion to consult with town council on, in a general way, on what the implications of town meeting votes would be, and hopefully chat with her, depending on her schedule, or communicate with her before Monday night and report to you all Monday night, just to see what's there. And I'll wait to hear a second, and if I don't, we'll go more.
I would rather wait on the letter of support and up that language, because, you know, until we get the host agreement squared away, there's, you know, that's kind of a side point. It's not really, because until this is squared away, we can't do anything with that.
My only reason for doing that is if by chance she does not offer the kind of language that I'd be comfortable with, then that also would just stop the whole thing in its tracks.
I think she will offer language. I'm pretty confident on that.
I know that we have a full agenda for the meeting that she is coming to, that the focus of that is going to be going over the
warrant. Oh, the warrant, yeah. Yeah.
But can we not ask her to have you call or ask her to think about it or prepare something that she can tell us at that time? That way we all hear it.
Yeah, I think that would be helpful. Maybe even start it earlier than what we had planned on and put some time in for that. That's 5-3, isn't it? March
yes.
3rd we're doing that, which is a Tuesday night. I think that's a great idea, because I'd love to hear what she says.
In terms of which topic or all of them?
All of them.
Yeah, so I would move that we authorize Mark to call her or email her our question and that she respond to us as a board.
Mm-hmm.
All right, not respond even in writing before the 3rd?
Well, I think that's not...
Okay.
That's not as critical. I guess what I'm thinking is that then everybody gets to hear her
right.
response.
Okay.
And that is probably helpful.
I'll check with her as to whether she can come earlier. If not, we'll just be prepared for
perfect.
A long night.
That's perfect.
All right.
Great idea, Colleen. All right, so I'll second the motion.
Pardon?
I'll second the motion.
Oh, we're changing the motion, though, I think,
yep.
aren't we?
Well, Colleen made a motion.
Yes, that you contact her with the questions, and she responds. She can respond to us in writing as a board, but also come prepared to speak to it.
To speak to
on
it.
That night.
Very good.
Awesome.
You second that?
I second.
All those that in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Terrific.
Okay. Okay. Let's just take 30 seconds to take a breath. Actually, let me just do a couple minor pieces of business before I forget. We mentioned this at the last meeting. The treasurer's office wants to remind everyone that there has been a return of a lot of the tax bills as undeliverable, with some changes going on in the post office. So if you have not gotten your tax bill, you certainly want to contact the treasurer's office by email. That's treasurer@town.plympton.ma.us or telephone number 781-585-0409. If you haven't gotten your tax bill, please contact the treasurer's office. So I got that one out of the way. While we're at it, just a couple more out of the way. I did speak with the fire chief. We did have presentation of certificates of completion on the agenda for next Monday night. That's going to be postponed for a while. We did have some communication earlier in the day from CONCOM wanting to come in and ask for some time with town council. That issue has been resolved, so we won't have to deal with those things Monday night.
Good.
All right. We will come to the town meeting warrant articles, but it's a little after 6, so let's go to Maple Street 6-3-6 driveway width issue. This has been going on for quite a while about the possibility of a group home on the west end of Maple Street, been before a lot of boards and committees. I did receive requests last week from a couple of neighbors or people living nearby that project, and so I think probably they should speak first. We do have the zoning officer, enforcement officer here. We do have the fire chief here. They may want to comment. I am going to just remind everyone, my best understanding of this is this has been a Conservation Commission issue. It has been a zoning issue. It has been a Building Committee issue and maybe fire. It has not been a Board of Selectmen issue as such. Whether it is now or not, I don't know. We are essentially offering a forum. If anyone can convince us that there's some action we need to take, we can certainly hear that. Neighbors first.
Yeah, Jean Correa, 112 Maple Street. Basically, first, I'm sitting here and I want to just say I feel really bad for everything you guys have to deal with. It's difficult, and I appreciate you giving us a couple of minutes, and I'm going to be really quick. Try not to overload your brains. I can feel so bad for you. But anyway, the thing is, we know that the other side is in an effort to try to get this driveway in with 10 feet when the bylaw has been for many years 12 feet. So it's now hair splitting that they are going to say the bylaw is so unclear that the 10-foot driveway should be allowed. So I spoke to a couple of attorneys, just asked them to review the bylaw, and Mike spoke to an attorney. So we have 3 attorney opinions. And we just asked them quite simply, look at this bylaw as it relates to residential driveways, tell us what you think, without any backstory at all. So the 3 attorneys, pretty quickly, all of them came to the same basic conclusions that what would go before a court is not the question of whether or not a 10-foot driveway should be allowed. The question would be simply, is it clear? So they all agreed that it could be worded better. It was a little bit unclear. But they feel that the town's intent is there, and for these reasons. Firstly, it is stated, it is written in there, minimum driveway width, one way, 12 feet. The prior rulings from the town, since that bylaw has been in effect, sets precedent. So they have for many years, and it's actually, Mike went back, got some copies of bylaws previously. It's been in effect that way at least since 1997. Nobody has ever come before the board and said it's unclear until you have a builder that can't take no for an answer, basically. So how the law has been applied by the zoning officer, which he's been around for at least maybe 8 years or 9 years, he's been consistently working with that bylaw, treating everybody with the same guidance. And we feel like that shows intent and precedence. And the attorney said that if it was even further questioned beyond that, you know, the court could ask the authors of the bylaw, what was your intent when you wrote this bylaw? We're not talking about constitutional law in a Second Amendment written a couple hundred years ago. You know, they're around, we can ask them. And there's also probably meeting notes that they had when they determined they needed 12 feet for safety reasons, or maybe they looked at other town standards. So there are ways to determine what the intent is without having to guess. And it is reasonable to assume that they never intended to have no standard for driveways, residential or commercial, in the town. I mean, it's unreasonable to think that that's what they meant to do, that alone. And they also said, they were pretty adamant in saying that they would have to have a very compelling case to win that issue, that hair-splitting issue, that it was, residential doesn't apply. So they don't think that they would win that. Let's see. They do think that if the court had to look at it, what they would ultimately determine and find is it's unclear, and they would probably say that they had to fix the wording in the bylaw within a specified period of time. They would not come and ask the town and say, you need to change that to 10 feet because it's unclear. That's not how they would go with that. Let me see, there was, like I said, it had gone back to 1997 at least. That's as far back as we could find it, and no one has ever questioned or said, this is so unclear, we can't go by this bylaw. So that's basically where that is. And we're hoping that the zoning officer, if he really wants to stand by his safety reasons for the 12-foot law that he has been going by for his length of time here, that the Board of Selectmen stands with him, gives him the strength to do what he thinks he needs to do with that bylaw. And to say that if he does want to not sign that zoning permit because it doesn't have the requirement, that at least 30, because we checked, at least 30 permits have been issued since 2008 that have been governed by that bylaw. That if he stands with that and says, in all fairness to all those who have come before and all those who will come in the future, he can't sign that zoning permit, that the town will stand with him, and he does have the support of town council if he needs it. And that's basically what I'm asking. I'm hoping that the selectmen will just stand with him if that's the way he decides to go, because it's his decision ultimately.
What are the bylaw, the numbers of the bylaws? Do you have those?
Mike has it. You have it. The number?
For the driveways.
Mike has
12
it.
Feet for one.
No, well, do you know what numbers they are?
He's got a copy of it right here.
In 2000, it's 6.4.2.
Okay, 6.4.
But it actually starts at 6.4, and the first paragraph talks about safe and convenient off-road parking.
Oh, right there. Middle of driveway width.
And what they're doing is they're trying to say that residential and commercial were excluded from that because the table above, it is really hair-splitting. It's a Hail Mary pass, really.
And residential is cited as the first line for the number of spaces that you need in the same section.
We agree. And our three attorneys that we spoke to, and I have copies of this for you guys, but one of them is an attorney that works in the construction industry for a risk management firm in Boston. He specializes in construction. Another one is a real estate attorney, and the third one is just a general practice attorney. So one of them said, you know, if the town wants my opinion, I'd give you your phone number, he'll review it, but I'm sure you probably would have someone else that you want to hire. Who are you?
He's the press. You're going to be out there in the paper.
Okay, well, I'm going to sit down then.
But not until next week.
My last thing is, and really, if you did need the names of the attorneys that we spoke to, I do have them. I would be happy to give them to you, but I just wrote this from my own notes when I took it, you know, discussed it with them. I authored it, but it's all legitimate based on what they told me. So I will give you each a copy if you want it. And I really appreciate having the opportunity to speak.
So why is 12 foot a problem
because they don't have room based on the wetlands
So is this new construction or is this an existing property? This is new construction?
This has been going on for years and years, and there's been a lot of problems with it. So this is their last ditch effort now to say, you know, this hair splitting issue over the bylaw negates it, and they should be allowed to put their driveway in, and it's brutal. So I'm going to give.
Did you want to say something as well? Oh, yeah? Okay. Okay. So whenever you're ready, you're, let us know who you are and your address, please.
I'll stand over here, Doug, off to the side. My name is Michael Mattern. I am an abutter, direct abutter to this project on Maple Street. I've been involved with the project since it started with the previous owner in 2004 and 5. And I've continued with the new owners since then with this project. To answer your question more directly, by the way, the issue for them at the moment is they, because of one of the permits that they have, which is grandfathered because of the Governor's Extension Act, they cannot widen the driveway. It's been approved for a wetlands crossing, which is no longer allowed in our bylaws for ConCom. But they have a permit that's grandfathered, and therefore, but it's 10 feet wide. And the sad part is that due to some errors and omissions in the beginning of this whole thing, if the wetlands delineation had been done properly, the vernal pool that is now certified less than 50 feet away from this driveway would have stopped them right at the beginning, because that's not allowed per state wetlands. But that didn't happen, so it's inched its way along. Anyway, that wasn't part of what I wanted to say, but that's what's been going on for a long time. Okay. Unfortunately, due to the best efforts of myself and others to try to prove why this should not proceed, using facts and relying upon town bylaws, we've been ineffective in stopping this project due to errors, omissions, and in some cases deception by both of the professional engineering companies that were involved. Professionals who provided critical information to our boards in making their decisions. Each of those have been proven at different points, but too late to change it. In the spring of 2014, our zoning officer denied their zoning permit due to the fact of this 12-foot driveway width requirement in our bylaws. As Gene said, I found out today that the bylaw goes back in the exact same wording, at least to 1997, maybe before, but that's the earliest that the town clerk could find for me today. And I compared it, it's exactly the same wording. Very unclear, but it hasn't changed. And to the best of my knowledge, it's not been challenged before. In February, so that stopped them at that point in spring of 2014. A year ago, February in 2015, their professional engineering company, PMP Associates, presented to a ConCom board a proposal to make a slight change to the approved wetlands driveway design, wherein they would be able to put 12 feet of driveway in a 10-foot space without changing the area, the final disturbance of the property, and especially the wetlands in particular. Sadly, the proposal was denied after it was proven that the math just didn't work. Okay, and it was actually downright fraudulent, actually. The way it was drawn was absolutely wrong, and that's not allowed in their kind of field. That shouldn't happen. It should also be noted that the same professional engineering company was involved in designing the layout of the second permit for the back half of the property where the house and the parking lot area is. There's a small section of driveway leading to that parking lot that's part of that permit, not the front one, with the wetlands. It's all wetlands, but I mean with the wetlands crossing, I should say. And in that section of the project, he made it 12 feet. So this engineer knew that our bylaw was 12 feet, because he purposely widened it from 10 to 12 in actually a very bizarre way. And the fire chief was kind of laughing about the way that you're going to like drive off the end of the world, because it's 12 and then suddenly it's 10. But you know, obviously he knows it was 12 feet, because it's at least 60, 70 feet, something like that, a 12-foot driveway. Mm-hmm. Okay, which makes no sense otherwise. Okay, the same night that ConCom denied that proposal of widening the driveway and not changing the permit enough to have to lose their grandfathered 10 wetlands crossing, there was another project that came before them, before us actually, wherein a project of similar in nature as far as wetlands are involved, a long driveway off the road at the other end of Maple Street, same street even, was brought before the board to show them that the zoning and fire chief had required some widths to be widened so that now the driveway would be 12 feet with 14 feet on the curb for the emergency vehicles. That's the same project. It's currently being worked on right now. They were there to show ConCom that everything was good, that, you know, and make sure that they were okay with it. In that case, I believe, as far as I know, there was no wetlands crossing involved, just, what do you call it, the buffer zone, that kind of thing. Most recently, in March of 2016, the attorneys for the owners, which one partner of that firm, Attorney Tollerman, is actually a former co-worker of our town council at Copeland and Page, sent a letter to the building department suggesting that the 12-foot driveway width requirement in our bylaw does not apply to this project due to the confusing language and formatting of the document. The paragraphs are not delineated very well. If they were meant to be separate, it's not clear. The language of that section, like I said, has been exactly the same as it is today for over 20 years. To their credit, our zoning officers have faithfully enforced this 12-foot width requirement without a challenge by any other project until now. That was their understanding and interpretation of the bylaw for all these years. The town's intent for public safety, especially critical for driveways of this length, nearly 400 feet long, where emergency equipment cannot operate effectively from the street, has been consistent, and a precedent of over 20 years is clear. Our bylaws clearly state that the zoning officer is to apply the bylaws to projects seeking approval based on his understanding and interpretation of the bylaws. The ZBA is the appropriate venue for an applicant to challenge the zoning officer's decision and to evaluate the intent of the bylaws in determining a resolution. So that's where this should be decided, if it's going to be decided anywhere, is at the ZBA level, not the zoning officer. So I would respectfully request that our zoning officer be encouraged by the Board of Selectmen to continue upholding the driveway width requirement in our bylaws as the town has intended for 20 years of, and our 20 years of precedent confirmed, as he has consistently done for over 8 years. It will then be the applicant's choice to bring the appeal to the ZBA, which is the correct process by which this should be resolved. And if they're not happy with that result, they can then go higher. But that's where it really should be resolved. So I'm just basically asking the selectmen to support our zoning officer in whatever decision he makes. And I hope that he will make the decision based on the intent that he is, or the interpretation that he has used all these years, and let the ZBA do their job. And if there's any question about the legal ramifications, I know that town council has had a different idea about this, but we have three attorneys that say differently. Then I would suggest that perhaps the selectmen should think about getting at least one other attorney that's not part of Copeland and Page to offer another opinion. If you don't, you know, it might be worth doing. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Any other neighbors wanting to speak? Okay, so I guess we'll call on Mr. Carling, the zoning enforcement officer.
I can't believe the attorneys can't agree on this.
Wise guy.
Bob, you're such a soft-spoken fella. Could you speak up a little for the old...
They denied the permit back in 2014. They did not appeal it to the zoning board. And it has gone this long since then. What I did get was a letter for reconsideration by the applicant's attorneys, which town council recommended, because of the wording in the bylaw, that I change my decision on this. I believe we spoke about it at the last executive session with Alana. And she doesn't feel the wording in the bylaw is appropriate, but in my defense, it would be the first time since I've been in the building department that I recall a causeway being built across wetlands, a replication to be built. I don't recall any other house or project similar to this. And So as far as getting some precedence from the building department, I'm not quite sure where we would go, other than the other end of Maple Street, which is a different project. What's going on right now? And naturally, I mean, more importantly, it's access for the fire trucks, the ambulance, and everything else. 10 feet wide with a slope on either side, going down into a swamp is something the fire chief isn't crazy about driving across during the middle of the winter. So they don't have a current approved zoning permit. And if they file for one, I'm not quite sure what to do with it. I would probably ask the town council's opinion again. But we're just going to get the same opinion, I'm gathering. That because of the wording of the bylaw, it should be allowed the way that it is.
She says it should be allowed?
Because it excludes residential and commercial for some reason. I don't understand why.
So is it the case that if you took the advice of town council, changed your opinion, if abutters or neighbors wanted, they could appeal your decision to ZBA?
That's correct. It opens up the appeal period once again.
For 30 days?
20 or 30, I forget which it is on this particular one.
All right. Do you have more to say? We want to touch base with the fire chief just so we're all in this together in one way or another. Do you have comments at this point, Chief?
I do. My job has nothing to do with zoning. It has to do with fire protection. And that's protection of human life and the protection of property. And I set a 12-foot limit because of the size of my trucks and the access of the trucks. We've measured our trucks. It's 9 feet 6 inches is the widest truck from tire to tire we have. And I think it's reasonable to expect for me to have 12 feet of a, you know, of a solid driveway surface or a plowable surface. It doesn't necessarily have to be tar, because these are all my decisions and all my judgments come from the 527 CMRs and NFPA 1. These are fire codes, sprinkler codes. There's nothing to do with zoning. So as of January 15, 2015, there is some new provisions as far as fire department access roads. And this chapter shall apply to public and privately owned fire department access roads, apparatus access roads. So I believe that I, on my own, am able to enforce a reasonable expectation for driveway widths and how they're built, grades, and everything else. For the most part, this doesn't apply to the normal driveway. And I know we haven't required 12-foot lengths of normal driveways throughout our town. It's because a fire truck in Plympton pulls up out front, we drop a tank in front of it, and it's fed by tanker trucks because we have no public water supply. We have pre-connected 200-foot lines on our trucks, so we can go 200 feet in. I don't have to worry about recessed areas or anything. I have a full access from the street. That's why I don't determine driveway widths on every building permit. This is a retreat lot or an extended driveway, so I have to have that capability. If one of those tires goes off that road and that truck gets stuck there, and the engine is 51,000 pounds, the tank is 69,000 pounds gross vehicle weight, we're done. Nothing can get down further. We're stuck right there, and we're gonna have to somehow feed in and schlep all of our equipment and our men and all our equipment, ladders, ventilation, suppression, everything in it, forcible entry potentially, and try to take this thing on. I don't think it's unreasonable that in the interest of public safety and for the protection of life and property that anyone wouldn't be willing to go with my 12-foot requirement. This is a fire protection issue for the fire department. They have submitted their fire protection plans, and I am currently reviewing them. And it includes the access road to this facility. That's where I am right now.
Can I say one more thing? It seems to me that they should be working together and standing together on that instead of maybe with the town council. That, you know, if every lawyer agreed on every instance, we wouldn't have court cases. You know, I mean, if she has her opinion, these three had theirs. They had no connection to anyone at the law firm representing the other firm. They didn't have any background noise. They just had a simple review. They looked at it, and, you know, I don't think one town council that goes against common sense should be the only view. I think common sense, and when you look at it, that is a hair split right there, and that is a Hail Mary pass. And I don't even know if they would really challenge it in court, because I don't think they really believe they'd win.
One other point, if we're going to go to ZBA on this thing, shouldn't it be the applicant that has to go to ZBA?
I think so too, instead of the town residents.
Protect our town.
Oh yeah, we shouldn't go to ZBA.
I say don't sign it.
If it goes to ZBA, it should go, they should be the ones that have to prove it.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Please don't sign it.
So just to be overly simplistic, Chief, you're feeling it, from a safety perspective, we need a 12-foot driveway. My understanding is there's no way they can put in a 12-foot driveway because of wetlands protection.
Isn't this a population that is that would need assistance?
Yes.
I think that it hasn't been clear what kind of population it will be. It is generally been understood that they might have limited mobility. Okay.
There's also another issue with regard to that. The parking area of the proposed dwelling does not have enough space for the emergency vehicles that would be called even for a standard rescue and operation. There's not enough room to, you can't even turn around the fire trucks. You'd have to back them back down the driveway, which is nearly impossible.
All right.
Did you say since 2008, this is the standard you've been going by?
Well, I mean, I don't recall how long it's been in there, to be honest with you.
But as long as you've been doing this job, you've been going with a 12-foot driveway?
Yeah, and typically, well, it's the only one that we've had a replication for. Whether it's, is there any?
I can't think of any others, other than the one on the other end of Amherst Street, which is currently.
I mean, it's never come up before. There's never been an issue.
Right.
Okay.
If I could add just one more thing. In the 527 CMRs, which also have many amendments from the NFPA 1, which is the National Fire Code, one of these sections is, when fire department access roads cannot be installed due to location on property, topography, waterways, non-negotiable grades, or other similar conditions, the AHJ, which is the authority having jurisdiction, which is me, shall be authorized to require additional fire protection measures and features. Mm-hmm. Some of the things we do, we suppress fires, we ventilate gases and fires, we do forcible entry. There's all types of things, we do many things. That's why our trucks are so filled up. They would have to provide those types of things at that site. Because by the looks of that driveway, it's 500, is it close to 500? 450, about 450 feet. If we can't get it in there, that means we gotta bring it in there. So it would be reasonable for me to expect them to have those items ready for me right there. Additional water, in addition to what's required by the sprinkler code, that they have to have at least 600 gallons of water to get started. I'd have to have them have a lot of extra water. Some of the equipment I need. It's unreasonable to think that they could provide it safely. And then in our full gear, we're still running 450 feet down the driveway if we can't get there, which could cause a loss of life and property, a delay in service. So I don't know what I could tell them. And I've been asked by town council to come up with a potential list of things I might have them there if they challenge me on this. I have a list. Park a fire truck down there, looks just like mine, is what I say, which more than likely unreasonable. But if I can't get there, I can't do anything. Mm-hmm.
Okay, the one thing I want to say is I think we have to be very careful what's under our authority here. And I think maybe we can express our opinion, but ultimately this is going to be a zoning enforcement officer's decision. Mm-hmm. He has to deal with the resources and the advice before him. So regardless of how we feel, I don't think we have the option of directing in any way the decision. And regardless how we feel, we do know that there is recourse for whichever side. This has been for a very long time a contentious issue. It hasn't been easy in any of the boards it's been before. There has been the constant concern and maybe even the constant threat that this could end up with court action and legal action. And I think we just have to be careful that we are being very strict in our interpretation of all of our duties, including any discrimination against group homes in any way. So that's what I can say. I don't have any opinion otherwise. I don't know if either of the Board of Selectmen wants to render any words.
I would just say public safety always comes first.
Okay.
Basically, I agree. I have no, really, we don't know what kind of home it is or anything, so I don't know how it would be called prejudice against them.
I mean, irregardless, it's just the building code describes it as a single family home.
Yeah.
And that's how we're looking at it.
Right.
And that is a key piece in the discussion on this, is we cannot discriminate against, I mean, it's against the law to discriminate against.
We wouldn't want you to.
That is, in all the years that I've been involved in just about every single meeting, that has never been the issue. It's always been about the facts, the data, the surveys, the all that kind of stuff. And it's never been about that, but they've tried to use that against us to scare us. You know, and we need to stand up for ourselves.
They have, and we do.
Okay.
I don't think there's any more action for us to take.
No.
I know you guys are on the hot seat. Happens up here a little bit too, and we get paid the not so big bucks for it.
He's a fireman. He can handle the hot seat.
That's right. He loves it.
Whatever's best for this community is. That's my paramount. Okay. It's reducing risk, reducing liability to the town, to the resident. And you would think that the owner of that developer would be very concerned when he goes to get insurance, or that whoever the vendor is that takes over there, that they've got themselves covered enough and they've taken reasonable care to make it safe for the resident.
We appreciate everybody coming in, and we're glad to have offered a forum, and we'll see how it goes. Okay. Another breath moment. Shall we do the sand and gravel permit so we have that out of the way? Okay, so we have before us a sand and gravel permit. Have we all had a chance to take a look at this?
Yeah, according to Bree, it looks like everything, it's complete.
Bree did let us know everything was complete, and I am willing to make a motion that we approve the gravel permit renewal before us.
Can I make a second for discussion?
Second for discussion, noted, and we open it for discussion.
Okay. How long has this permit been open? Jeff, do you know?
I think the first phase was, I honestly can't tell you when we started, but when we completed the first phase, you, Joe, and
Rick.
Rick came down, we did the second phase. I don't know if that was 5 years ago or...
No, it would have been longer ago than that, because I left in 2006.
Maybe it was in that, so what is it?
Okay. So what phase are you on now?
The second phase.
Okay, second phase. When do you think
first
you're going to be done with it?
My operation is kind of, a boutique operation. We don't move a lot of material, so, it's a very, limited scope. So I'm not really sure. We were kind of waiting for the cranberry industry to recover a little bit, but, so we haven't been, going crazy. And I think that was pretty much an agreement that we had made with the town, that we were going to do it in a fairly slow fashion that lessened the impact on anybody. And that's what we've been trying to do, is handle it that way.
Any idea when it'll be done? A couple years? 2 years?
I don't actually know, because if, I just, I
Okay.
I can take a look and try and figure something out and get back to you on that.
Well, I'd love to do a site visit. It's been so long since we've been down there. Yeah, so I would love to get down there and take a look at it and see what you've got going on. But yeah, okay, those were all my questions.
Do you need the site visit before?
I would really like to see, I'd like to just, can we do it, I mean, we could even go this weekend, and we don't even have to all go together. It doesn't have to be a posted meeting. I could just meet you down there,
and
or even tomorrow after work.
I don't mind doing that, with the exception that, you know, this is a busy time of year for us. You know, this is, we don't sell any material really in the late fall or the winter or in the early spring. The only time that we sell material really is this time of year, and we do have customers that would put us in a hardship. I don't, you know, I'm confident that you won't find anything. Mark has actually been down on that site when we looked at the road.
Mm-hmm.
He's seen it, I'd appreciate it.
We'll catch you.
If you could vote on it, if you came and found something that you found was an error or wrong,
okay.
I think that would be
okay.
You know,
okay. Well, I mean, we still could do the permit Monday.
I wonder if we could vote the permit tonight pending a satisfactory.
Sure.
Yeah.
Okay.
Absolutely.
So let's.
I forgot to bring it with me, but I read his gravel permit exclusions. And nowhere in it does it mention that he can import dirt into his property. Yet we've all seen trucks going into his property with dirt. So what I can't figure out is how do you figure out how much gravel that you have left to remove if you're bringing gravel in? The second thing I wondered about is who's going to enforce the regulations that come with this gravel permit? You know, the hours of operations are 8 to 4 during the week, 9 to 1 on Saturdays. The day after the selectmen's meeting when we pointed out that he didn't have a permit, I could hear trucks at 7 o'clock in the morning the next day. Who do you call? Chief of police? Do we call you guys at home? Who's monitoring
this? It'd be us.
Yeah, it's probably us.
It's
and
us.
Then we pass the word to somewhere.
And the trucks are supposed to exit his property and go right down Ring Road.
Mm-hmm.
No, that was amended Article 15.
And I must have gotten an old copy of the permit.
It's okay. But it is in the amendment of Article 15. I think it's called Article 15. And the town decided that it was in the interest of the community to go left and right.
That's what I thought, too.
Yeah.
But then this most recent one
right.
said right only, because I
right.
thought no. the Kingston residents said we can't just go right.
Yeah. I think it's called an amendment to Article 15. It's
okay.
somewhere in the document.
I remember that,
yeah.
that you couldn't just go right, because that... Yeah.
Yes.
But we couldn't send you just through Kingston.
Right.
But the importing...
As much as we wanted to.
and a couple things about... Two things. One is we do bring in... We have we compost all of our manure for our barn, for our horses. We do bring in products that do augment that compost. But, you know, that's really part of our farm operation, right? You know.
But these are truck after truck after truck. I mean, it's not just an isolated truck.
Well, we also haul sawdust in. We have, you know, my trucks also work at other sites. So our trucks leave in the morning and then come back at night. They go up for service. They go for fuel.
But these have dirt in them coming into your property. And where is this bog being developed? I mean, I cut through the impermeable woods last night to look to see. And I don't see anything except... piles of dirt being moved from one section to the other, a big pile of rocks. It's two cranberry bogs that are over by the bog pond haven't changed in years.
Maureen, with all due respect, that's trespassing.
No, I was on my own property, Jeff. I bought
your property.
I can actually, since you've cut down all those trees, I can see right to where the grow facility is supposed to go.
So good luck with that.
The trees haven't grown, they're not leafed yet. It's very easy to see. And I'm not trying to be difficult. I'm just, you know, for years we've knowing he had this. We heard him working early. We let it go. It's not a big deal. But now it's become a big deal. And I don't know who's going to police it or who's going to keep an eye on it. It's just... Because I don't want it to be me. or, you know, or the neighborhood or the other neighbors who have all complained about this.
Well, I certainly, if we approve this, whatever's in there, the applicant's required to do. If he doesn't do it, and if people report it to us, then it's up to us to take action. I mean, there have been other sites where there have been conditions that haven't been taken care of, and we get the call, so I think that's how that one would go.
Mm-hmm. Do you see anything in there about the... I read the whole thing, and I didn't see...
And number 15 has nothing to do with turning.
It's separate.
Oh, it's a separate page?
Yeah, I think so. I can bring it in for you, but the town voted for it because the people in Kingston felt that they were being...
I remember. I think that I was involved in that.
Yeah, sure. No, and I have a copy of it, I think, and I think Brigitte and I looked at it. And I also owe Brigitte a public apology because... she reminded me after the fact that we had the conversation we had talked about our father. So I do remember calling and asking me about, I know we had a conversation about our fathers, and it was right around the time when she was going through renewing the permits after, usually you send us a notification, a written notification renewal, like in July, and we didn't get it, we didn't pick up on it. I didn't remember the content of my conversation with Brigitte. I should have never impugned her, my error. And ultimately, it's my error that it didn't get renewed. That's my responsibility, and that burden falls on me.
Well, she would appreciate that.
Okay. So maybe as part of the site visit, you can produce the document that will assure us on the turning. All right, so there is a motion before us to tentatively, or any other comments, discussion. So the motion before us to tentatively approve this document, to sign it next Tuesday, pending, or forgive me, next Monday, pending a satisfactory site review and clarification of the truck turning over the weekend. So all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Okay.
Who made the motion and who seconded?
I made the motion.
Second and...
Okay.
I just see, it looks like in 2003, condition 15 of the permit condition stated September 27th, 1999 is hereby repealed. But you think it was 15 was the one that did the...
15 is the one that says it has to go right.
Okay.
That's exactly the document. I think it was a single page.
Okay, so I'll just... Yeah, it's just a single page.
I don't read that number 15.
It's been replaced. I'd have to find the original one, which we probably still have, that's like dated before this with that language on it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Because it looks like we did that in 99.
Okay.
Okay.
So that's out of the way.
Okay.
Okay.
So, Jeff, I'll give you a call to set up a time. Maybe Saturday morning would be good, you think? Perfect.
Be nice to her.
Oh, he's always nice.
Okay, we've gone a little out of order here, but in the interest of the fire chief's time, we'll go up to the top item, which at our last meeting, we had some questions or wanted some clarification from the fire chief. So Monday night, we, the Board of Selectmen, will have to, I think it'll probably be Monday rather than tonight, vote our recommendation on all of these. So, Chief, we had questions about Articles 11, 12, 13, and 14, I guess.
Okay.
Oh, sorry, one second.
I had some information about different states and how they handle agriculture and marijuana, and I'd leave this up to you guys.
Okay.
You can
Perfect.
Okay. Let us look through that.
Thank you.
I am aware that I kept the discussion of all that up here tonight. We will certainly offer an opportunity Monday night for others. We've offered a lot of opportunity along the way. We'll continue to do that for any new information along the way. Okay. Back to Fire Chief. Chief, we were just wanting to hear from you about these appropriations and why you are recommending them.
Okay. Fire away.
Pardon?
Fire away.
Oh, I thought I had given it over to you.
Well, what are your questions?
Okay, so the first one was about the air packs.
Okay.
And the reason you're asking for new air packs.
Yes, okay, this is, Plympton is part of a county
pretty much a county-wide program to the federal government for an assistance to firefighters grant to get brand-new air packs, the SCBA air packs, what firefighters use in compromised atmospheres. The cost of them are $7,500 a piece. Ours are of 1994 vintage. They were upgraded in 2006 to meet the current standard. And in 2009 and 2010, the town got us 9 new bottles each year. So the bottles are well within testing time and use. But we thought we'd get on board with this county program because for 2 years in a row, I've applied for granting through the federal government to replace them and have been turned down. They don't tell you why they turned you down, but I have a fairly good idea. It has to do with our run volume, how many calls we have a year, how many fires we have a year, and also potentially our population. They, you know, we're under 3,000 people. Some of the towns are getting hits on this type of thing, usually bigger towns. And they also look at the kind of age and the level of equipment that you have overall. And for the most part, the town has gotten the fire department in pretty good shape. So those are some of the factors that come into why we do not get approved for granting. So this year, a number of fire chiefs in the area got together and we decided to do a group grant together. It's an actual $1.9 million grant. So this warrant article has to do with the 10% matching funds the Plympton has to come up with. And that's what that warrant article is for. If we get the grant, it could be sometime in April all the way to sometime in July when we'll know. So I had to know from the town that it was possible that I could get that money appropriated. And only upon acceptance of the grant would I ask after July 1st to have you guys cut a check for that 10% matching amount.
Okay. Great.
Good luck.
Hopefully we get it.
I think to say so.
I'd like to say that the air packs were all replaced around 2005, all 20 of them.
Yes, they were upgraded. They were upgraded.
I was told that they were completely replaced, and that's why you're not getting the grant, because they're supposed to be good for 20 years.
Right. They were. John Walker purchased them somewhere around.
No, David purchased them.
No, he had them upgraded. They had to have the pass device, which lets you know for firefighters, had to be integrated into the pack. There was a buddy breathing system added, but the frames were on when I came. They were all there when I came on in 97. I mean, there was an upgrade which met the current standard, and we were allowed to go forward. That's how that happened.
Okay.
I don't know. I heard you won't get the grant for 20 years.
I don't know what that, I'm not sure what that means.
That they're supposed to be good for 20 years.
I don't know that. I'm not sure. All I can do is apply as I should every year if I can, because it's about $165,000 deal for us. So if I can get 90% of it paid, I'll try to do that. But you might be, I don't know that. I don't have the exact answer to, but I am correct on the time frame. The bottles we replaced, 18 of them. The town bought us 9 in 2009 and 9 in 2010, and they're good for 15 years.
Okay, so next is Article 12, which is $12,000 for upgrades and repairs and incidental expenses.
Yes, okay, and I should give you guys a copy. I don't. I've got one for the Finance Committee. Part of that, the biggest part of that, is a fire alarm system for the fire station. The town's known for at least as long as I've been here as the chief that there is no fire alarm system in the station whatsoever. What there is battery-operated smoke detectors and carbon monoxide detectors. The hope was that we would be, in a timely fashion, either rebuilding the fire station or replacing it. Well, by the looks of it now, I don't see that that's going to happen anytime in the close proximity time frame. And I felt it was important for me to bring it forth to the town that we have almost $1.7 million worth of equipment in there. And we should be protecting with a proper fire alarm system with the proper central station notification if something happens there. One of the things we did when we put the trailer in, the building in over there, was the life safety human factor is out of it now. They're in the trailer. So if a fire were to happen in the station, we'd lose apparatus, we wouldn't lose people. And that was a very big concern and risk for the town. In addition to the fact we didn't have the proper space to provide overnight lodging for the for the round-the-clock crews that are there. So I felt it was important for me to bring it forward for discussion, to explain why. The question is, do we, as we all can agree, I would say, is do we want to spend the money now? Do we think we're throwing good money after bad? Are we taking reasonable care to protect this equipment and these people? These are codes and mandates that are statewide, and we are in violation. And are we taking reasonable care, or are we negligent? Those are the things that I wanted to bring up for discussion by bringing this forward. Question is, does the town want to spend that money now, or hope that in the very close future we build a new station, refurb that station? I don't know. But I had to bring it forward, because we're in a bad spot with it, not having protection. And it includes pulse stations, horns and strobes, heat detectors, all the things that you would have in any structure, and all the things that I would require for any business or residence to have that we do not have in our fire department. Okay, so that's what that is. That's the biggie.
Okay. Any questions, comments?
If we were to build a new fire station, could we take that with us?
Certain the notification stuff, the horns and strobes, mm-hmm. the pulse station, sure, you can take them off.
Mm-hmm.
Well, yeah, that's all to code. The, you know, the dialer, the telephone dialer to central station notification, sure. Yeah, and there's also the little pole station. Yeah, you could move some of that stuff.
Okay, so a lot of it.
You could sell, yeah, you could salvage a lot of that. The heat detector, you could undo them.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, you said that's the largest portion of it. What's the other?
Yes.
What's the breakdown of it, and what are
okay,
the
Okay, sure. The next part is to replace the working mechanism of the third door. The opener, it works by hand, but it doesn't work by automatic, and they have no electric eyes to sense if somebody crosses in front of it, and it could close on its own and hit somebody. And it also doesn't have the option of the remote opening for the trucks to come and go. We've repaired it and repaired it and repaired it. You can no longer get parts for it. And I've got some various prices, and they're off the wall, but I did get a gentleman to give me a price of $1,085 now. Originally it was going to be a lot more. To put in a lift master industrial duty commercial trolley opener and motor, a 3-button wall control remotes, and a pair of safety photoelectric eyes for that door. And that was $1,085 installed.
Does that include the door too?
No, the
okay,
door.
Okay, that's fine. Just the mechanisms.
Just the mechanism, just the closing mechanism.
Okay.
And how much was the alarm system?
The alarm system total is $5,296.63.
Okay, so what's the rest of the?
Okay, and then the next one is the main entry door with the key punch lock. The frame is all rusted, and on at least two occasions this winter we could not get in because the mechanism was so worn out, it was frozen shut. The door is swollen, we planed it, we played around with it, I jacked the jam out and forced it in with some bolts to pull it away. It's failing, we couldn't get in, we actually had to break into the station, luckily it wasn't a call. The pricing to replace the door with a white aluminum narrow line commercial door with a simplex number code combination paddle latch, new hinges, new door closer, and that's it. $3,284. The lock system alone is $884. And I've been asked, well, could we get Silver Lake to do it? Yeah, we might be able to. I don't know what time is. I still have to buy the stuff. I mean, you could go with some much cheaper doors. It has to be fire rated, I can tell you that. I don't have an exact price. But this is to do what you should do to make it work right and have it to be a good quality fire rated door that operates and works in all weather conditions. I hate to spend the money on it, but we have to be able to get in. That's the real stickler here. And we do need security. We do need to have that lock, and I couldn't believe the price of that time, Tyson. But it's a heavy-duty unit.
So that sounds like worst-case scenario. You might be able to get it done cheaper?
I think we could. Yeah, I think we could, yeah. I'll need some money to do it. And actually, I kind of put together a price calling Home Depot for some heavy doors and a less than super duty keypad control like we actually installed in the trailer. And I got it down to, not installed, but I got it down to about $1,200 for the parts. Okay.
Okay.
And there was a couple $1,000s there to, we're painting the front offices because we're going to be there for a while. And the guys, we're doing it on our own. We have some paint on stock, but the floors are horrendously bad. I would wanted to go with like one of those parquet floors or something, or a pre-finished flooring. And I figured there's got to be about $1,500 worth of supplies needed. And the bathroom fixtures are in bad shape. I got to at least either remove or replace the urinal. It's leaking, we can't tighten it, we've had it looked at. You know, it's the place, it is 40 years old. It's a good building, it really is, mm-hmm. but it's one of the things I'm looking to do.
Okay.
To at least, put it in the short term, make it usable and serviceable.
Okay, on Article 12 then?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Article 13, 11,000 for IV pumps. How many pumps is that?
That's two. As of January of 2017, the state has said that all advanced life support ambulances have to have an IV pump to deliver certain drugs. And it's a requirement, it's a state protocol, it will be part of the annual inspection that occurs, and you must have it on your trucks.
Okay.
We've looked for some potentially used ones. They're really not out there much yet. We're always working on somehow buying the used certified stuff. I bought a monitor, which is big money. I bought a certified monitor for $8,900 for the other truck. So we're always trying to find a deal, but there's not a lot of those out there right now. I can't remember the drugs it actually addresses. I'm not a medic. It addresses a certain set of drugs that must be delivered by automatic pump.
So these are required, but we don't have them at this point?
We do not have them. Nobody has them yet. Some of the privates do, that do extended transports into the cities and stuff, or inter-facility transports. They are not any 911 systems. I don't think there's a fire department around that I've talked to. I know there isn't, that have them yet. They're all looking at somehow purchasing them.
Okay. All right, on that one?
Just a quick question. You're grouping with somebody else to get, with the community to get grants, the fire community to get grants.
Yes, correct.
Can you also do a group purchase and get a lower price on something like this?
You're only allowed to do a certain amount of assistance of firefighters grants per year, and it's 3.
Right, but not even a grant. But, you know, if you're buying 10 things, you get a lower price than if you buy 2. So if other towns are in the same position and need to buy...
Yeah, and we've done that on other things. We could absolutely look at that.
Kingston, Halifax,
yeah.
Carver.
Oh, yeah, they're all
I mean, if nobody's got them, they're all going to be buying them.
Faces. We could do group buying.
Okay.
Yeah, I will check right into that. And I can just tell you, that's Carver's, if you don't have that option, that's the price. But, yeah, group buy, of course.
Okay. Art's got his hand up back there.
Okay.
I have a question. If it's required on advanced life support, we only have one advanced life support ambulance in town. So why do we need two of these things?
We do have two advanced life support ambulances. The second ambulance is at that level. It is licensed at that level. So that if the one leaves in town and we have an additional call, that it's able, we're able to bring it up.
Okay.
Okay.
I guess if I may elaborate slightly on that, we need at least... In order to be at the ALS level, we do need to have that on that truck. And you can't switch them if one truck's out already. The only option would be to buy one now and try to buy another later, but the truck will not pass the licensing requirements. I don't think that's an option. I think we have to buy both.
Okay, last one, Article 14 is $8,000 for any energy efficient upgrades to the lighting.
The town did an energy assessment of all our buildings. Eversource, what was that start of the time? Did an assessment of energy use, and they came up with a plan to replace the lighting. All the buildings in town, as far as I know, have been done except for the fire department. So I contacted Eversource and asked them to do a reevaluation of it. They did that with the modern fixtures that are now available only a few years later. And they came up with a price of, which I have, and I'll give you a copy of this too. Price of $10,030 or something, and they give some granting to it, and comes to $8,100. It's a 2.5 year rate of return. We will make our money back in 2.5 years, a complete rate of return. And again, are we going to have a new fire station tomorrow? Probably not. But the current problem now is, a lot of the ballasts are dying in the long lights, a lot of the bulbs are gone. I can't even replace them. I'd have to modify them.
the old, you know, the old side fluorescents. A lot of the ballasts are gone, and I am throwing money away on the electric bill over there, let me tell you. So again, with a 2.5-year rate of return, I thought it was a good idea. And you know we're going to be there for a little while at least.
Yeah. It's like more than 2.5 years.
Right.
There's no other way to get more grants for this. You know, we have the Green Community Grant that changed the lights in all the buildings.
We left the fire department out of the Green Community Grant. And he's got a quote from the same company who actually did all of the retrofits, TNC Energy. And I saw the quote. Until we close out the current one, remember we still have to do that dipsy doodle with the state on the current one.
Mm-hmm.
I don't believe there are some non-competitive grants available, but I tend to doubt we'd probably be eligible for any this time since we were that new out of the that we just were designated and just got $140,000 or whatever it was. So I don't. You can probably find it. I mean, in
copy of their outline and assessment. Yeah.
Thank you.
I mean, what you are getting is you're getting over $2,000 in incentives from NSTAR to put it in. Same thing we did when we did Dennett and we did this building. That's how it works.
Conceivably, we could move some of these things over to a new building as well.
Okay. I think that covers that. You'll be ready to defend these at town meeting floor? Okay.
Thanks, Chief.
Anything else with the fire chief?
No.
Well, since we're going to go over every article, do you want to make a blanket vote on these as far as whether the board supports them?
Actually, that's the next agenda item is what we want, if we want to do any of that tonight.
You probably should do it tonight as far as taking a vote on which articles you support and which ones you don't, because that's going to make it.
Are we prepared to do that tonight, or do we?
No, I've read the warrant. I could do it. I'm ready.
Okay. All right. Let's check with Colleen, though, because she's been away.
If you just give me a minute or two at each time to think, if necessary.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. So thank you, Chief.
One statement, non-inflammatory in any way. But you know, I think the supporters of the Grow Up support it for three reasons. One, there's a shortage of medical marijuana. You know, medical marijuana is approved and it helps sick people. And then the third is the tax revenue. So I just want to go on record that saying, I think by doing the hosting agreement and dangling $2 million in front of people will really taint the whole process.
Yes.
You don't have to discuss it with me, but I just think that it really does taint it. And I just don't think it's fair. So I just want to say.
Let's talk more Monday night.
Yeah, exactly.
Just for the heck of it.
Could I just make one comment, too?
Okay. One comment. Well, we've bent over backwards to make sure everyone had a chance to say what they needed to say. So
this is my first opportunity tonight.
Tonight.
Colleen, this is for you. You seem like a nice woman, and I don't know you at all, but I think you got a good heart. But I just couldn't leave tonight without reacting to your comment about people on the other side who oppose the farm are more divisive than people who are for it. I just don't think it's accurate. I think because we question the legality of it and the location of it doesn't make us divisive. And I think by you saying that, it kind of fans the flames for divisiveness. What's so funny about that?
I'm not sure we want to go here tonight. If you want to go further with this discussion, I will comment about that. But
we listen, but we don't get an opportunity. I don't know what I'm saying is so funny. Every time I say something, you laugh. I find it disrespectful.
I am so sorry to disrespect you. I think we have been incredibly respectful every way along the way. I do not feel like opponents of this have been particularly respectful. When opponents, not you, but others, loudly use hate language
this
excuse me, now it's my turn. use hate language about people's personal lives and personal lifestyles, that's divisive. When people go to the State House and question the intelligence of a couple of selectmen here because there are six different opinions, I find that divisive. I don't think we have to get into a discussion about who's more divisive. I do feel like we've given every opportunity for everyone to speak, and they've had that opportunity. I think... quite frankly, I think even the selectmen up here who have been opposed to this have been incredibly respectful, incredibly civil. I don't want to get into any other discussion of who has or hasn't. What we can do is control ourselves, and I believe we've done that. I hope the opponents can do the same.
Do you understand why someone might seem it's disrespectful when you laugh and smile when they're talking? Do you understand why someone like me would experience that as being disrespectful?
No. You know, I am so sorry. I'm not apologizing for smiling. I'm apologizing that you feel this way, that we have not treated you with respect. I think if you look at the body of this whole discussion, actually, I'm going to stop this discussion after this comment. If you look at the body of how we have handled this every step along the way, I feel like we have bent over backwards to be fair. We're probably in some trouble now because I've allowed us to spend too much time bending over backwards to be fair, but we're going to continue to do that. I'm going to continue to support that and nurture that as best we can. Enough. One last comment from you, if you'd like, and then we can go at this some more Monday night.
I'll be honest with you, I don't know what to say at this point.
Do you want to finish saying that, Colleen?
Just that I think sometimes, like I said, I think you have a good heart, and I think you're a nice person. I don't really know you, but I get a sense that you... a fair person, and I just found that comment about because we question if this is the right place for it and whether it's legal, that we've become divisive.
No.
May I respond,
Mr. Chair?
Please.
It isn't that. Sitting here and seeing everybody out there, from my perspective, when you give your points, everybody is sitting and listening. When Mr. Randall gives your points, certain members of your group, and I'm not even sure that I could say who, but certain members of your group loudly make derisive comments. And to me, that's also very disrespectful and feeds a fire of distrust and hate in the town. And that was... probably basically what I was talking about.
Okay, I'm gonna end this discussion tonight. Let's.
But I think we need more of it. You know, every time we get into this, we need to end it. And I think if anything, we need more conversation.
But I think everyone's had the opportunity to say what they need to say. I'm gonna leave it at that. Let's move on. The next agenda item is, I listed this as additional planning preparation discussion and actions on town meeting warrant articles. I wanted to see if I could get how many action verbs I could get in there to cover anything that might come up. I think the main thing is whether we vote. I think there are a couple things. We did receive yesterday the vetting from town council. Mm-hmm. It's good to have that. And I don't think maybe there's any additional action that comes out of those. We can go down these one by one and make our recommendation vote tonight if we feel ready. You have said
well, it's only,
you are.
We're only voting on what the articles, the money articles, right?
The warrant looks for support from the board or non-support from the board on every article.
On every article?
Yeah.
Yep.
That's the way you've had it traditionally since I've been here.
Okay.
I mean, and if you want to make it easy, you could do a little consent calendar on this, too. I mean, Articles 1 through 7 are standard. They appear every year. There's always a 3-0 vote by the Board of Selectmen. If you wanted to take those as a block. And that's, you know, to hear committee reports, compensating balance agreements, wage and personnel classification, the annual budget, and financial audits for the year, borrow money for Chapter 90, and the revolving accounts for the treasurer and the rec commission.
All right, so the bigger question, are we going ahead with this process?
Well, yeah, it's up to
you,
Colleen.
If you
feel like, I mean, we could wait till Monday if you'd be more comfortable.
I mean, if there's a couple of
50 articles between the two warrants.
Okay. Let's go through it. If there are a couple we have questions we're not sure on, we'll come back.
Wait till Monday.
Yeah, we can always hold off till Monday on the ones we don't understand.
I am going to make a motion then that we recommend we vote to round meeting Articles 1 through 7.
Okay. I'll second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, so there aren't that many. Let's just go down the list. Number 9 is...
That's a standard. Number 8, actually. Number 8 is a standard. That's the lease for 2 police cruisers. Some years it's 1, some years it's 2. Happens to be 2 this year.
Okay.
And then the next one is a new one this year. It's $15,360 for a radio repeater for the police department.
All right, so let's do 8. Any discussion on 8? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right. Number 9 is the police repeater, which I have understood in the past to be a significant safety issue for communication.
Yeah, between.
Between officers, and especially since we're a small department, it seems pretty essential.
Mm-hmm.
So I make a motion we approve that one.
Okay. Second.
Those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
May we simply, we'll leave out the first and the second and just vote?
Yes.
Okay.
That sounds good.
I think we're up
to... Unless there's discussion.
Okay. And we each probably feel totally capable of speaking up if we need to.
Number 10 is the lease payments for fire apparatus. So we've got 2 more years at this number of 104,691, then it drops to 48,000. 2 of them will be paid off.
Ooh, that'll be nice.
We've been paying that for a couple of years.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. 11.
And then you just went over the fire chief, 11, okay. 12, 13, and 14. If you want to take those as a block, or maybe you don't, I don't know.
Let's just do each one just in case. I will say I am going to... I don't know if we have to get in a long discussion. I am concerned hope that we're going to have a police station fairly soon. I hate to spend a lot of money, but I think 11, of course, this is essentially matching money. If we get the grant, we get it. If we don't get the grant, we don't spend it.
Right.
I'm definitely in favor of that. Okay, so we're good on that. Mm-hmm. 12, 13, and 14 are capital improvements, and I think albeit it's money, it's fairly moderate amount of money for a big department and a big budget, and I think they are reasonable things.
Okay.
Particularly if the chief is willing to get the school to do some of it, to look for a few more grants.
Right, and buying power.
And
buying
power.
Yeah.
I think that's
okay. So we're good on 12, 13, and 14.
Yes.
All right. 15 is the usual yearly Community Preservation Committee divvying up as required by law for the various reserve accounts.
Aye.
All those in favor?
Aye.
16 is an open space committee project asking for $30,000 to continue their work on exploring and facilitating the transfer, donation, and acquisition of land for open space and recreation.
And this is one that we've approved in previous years.
We approved one for I can't remember whether it was $10,000 or $15,000, maybe last year or 2 years ago, a couple thousand dollars of that were used to explore Parsonage Road and decision not to pursue it. A few thousand dollars of that are what led to the O'Neill Marsh donation. Mm-hmm. And so really very cost effective. They want to continue that kind of work.
All right, this one I'm going to vote against.
Okay. I am in favor.
So why is this an increase? Have we used up all the funds in the past?
No, there's a bit left. The thought would be rather than coming each year, coming once, and that using this over several years, giving some flexibility for larger projects if they came along.
Okay, so the thought is that this will not be on the article next year.
This what?
This will not be on the warrant next year.
No, that's the hope. And in fact, it might be a few years before this was used up.
Mm-hmm. Okay, aye.
So that'll be 2-1,
mm-hmm.
Dale.
Mm-hmm.
Just a reminder, while I'm thinking of it, we did have a discussion last year that the wording on this is recommended by BOS, and we ended up inadvertently last year or the year before with language that went recommended by BOS 1-1. So if we end up with any tie votes here,
how's that going to happen?
Think we're going to have to
BOS
find...
BOS recommendation will just be 1-1. Or if you end up with a 2-1 against, then it'll be not recommended.
Right.
Not recommended.
I think Finance Committee brought up, and I kind of agreed, that it's funny language to say recommended 1-1. So maybe this won't come up. But if it does come up, I think we need to discuss it more.
Yeah, I just put no recommendation at that. Actually, it's not going to come up 1-1 because there are three.
I'm going to recuse on a couple. So I just...
Okay.
I got the seed of an idea there.
Well, that comes up 1-1.
Why does that
one
say Board of Assessors?
Yeah, that's what I was wondering.
That
On 16, which we just did.
That would be an error.
What's that?
16 says Board of Assessors. It says sponsored by Plympton Community Preservation Committee, and then it's got Board of Assessors under there.
It should be Community Preservation. 16?
Yeah, 16.
Community Preservation. We'll make that change.
Okay. Just going to go back and check the other ones.
That's what I need a lot of eyes on these.
Okay.
Okay.
The next two are standard assessor's articles for the triennial valuation and the interim year valuation.
All right. This is 17 and 18?
17 and 18.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Any concerns?
The 3,000 is an annual update they have to do with their, they have to annually update their records so that they can keep, by law, they have to keep the assessments between 90 and 110% of true, of 100% evaluation. That's every year. And then the fiscal 17 triennial, they're required by law to do a reeval of the entire town every 3 years, which comes in at three times that 6,500 number.
Everybody okay with these?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So, both of them. All right, number 19.
We don't have a number for this one yet, do we?
We don't. And I'm not sure where they're, the last that I talked with the Finance Committee, they were talking about $250,000 from capital every year for the next couple
of
years.
I would like to discuss this when Finance Committee comes in with us Monday.
All right, let's hold it.
Hold that one.
All right. 20 is... I think it's our next to last payment. This was the reimbursement.
I think it's the last one.
There's been another recommendation then from the FinCom, actually. They have enough money. What they're recommending, first of all, they're recommending taking this off the annual and putting it on the special.
Put it on the special.
It can go either way. And they're recommending doubling it. Pay it all off this year rather than paying it this year.
Oh, I thought the 26 was the last of it. Okay.
No, year on the 26.
Gotcha.
Beyond this year, so they're looking at
to pay it off.
26. Yeah, it
this
will pay
year
it
in
off
the special.
This year. We'll pay Kingston everything we own.
Okay, so that's going
to
move to the special.
Are we going to hold on that and just talk about it Monday night?
Okay.
Okay.
All right. 21 is
Silver Lake.
The Silver Lake. I did write to Maureen Springer. She had originally asked for time to come in Monday night to speak with us.
Let's hold it then.
So she hasn't responded yet. We may have to make a decision. Well, we'll make a decision with as much information as we have.
Actually, the Kingston, I got a notification today. Kingston is having a hearing on this. Unfortunately, it's during your selectmen's meeting.
They're having it right now.
I think it's right.
That's what we were going to go. Decided that we were going to do our work instead.
Oh, okay. All right. Well, you can put this all on hold and go.
Yeah. So
makes my night because I get them out of here an hour.
All right.
That would be way too easy for you, Dale.
All right. So article. We're now into the citizens' petition section. I will just share with you, I am going to be against all of the citizens' petitions except the two of the land ones, which I'm going to recuse myself on.
Okay.
But I guess we'll go down each one.
Can we hold this? Because I think FinCom had some concerns about this. Can we discuss this further with them?
All right. So 22, we're going to hold.
Yeah, let's hold 22.
22 through...
23 is also the capital stabilization thing.
Can we hold that one too?
Absolutely. And, 24 is the repeal of the Community Preservation Act.
I'd like to do a little bit more research on this. I really haven't checked on this. Can we hold this one too, 24?
Glad to hold it.
Okay.
I am glad to... tonight, Monday night, any time, talk with you during a meeting about what CPC has done for this town and what an amazing deal it is in terms of the state match.
Okay.
Did you get the document that John Traynor prepared?
I think I did, but I haven't had a chance to read it.
It will show that we, over the last 8 years, we, the Community Preservation Committee, which I chair, have spent brought to town meeting and had approved about $200,000 worth of projects. We have about $400,000 in various categories. We have been scrupulously and fastidiously careful to choose cost-effective projects and I'm glad to talk about the benefits to the town of all of that. And we have been very careful to hold on as much money so that the day that a really special project, a bigger cost project came along, we could be ready to do it.
Okay.
All right. 25 is the one of the demo delay bylaws.
This one is what, changing it? From it's the time, right? Is that what this one
does?
From
18 to 6.
My concern on both of the demolition bylaws is these are, and my concern actually about all of the citizen petitions, but particularly the demo bylaws, these are really complicated issues. There are town committees, boards, and commissions that should be thinking about this for an extended period of time. Even if I agreed with this delay, I would want this to run through the appropriate channels first.
Who is the appropriate channel for this?
I think this would probably go under the
Historical Commission?
Yes.
The other thing that puzzles me is that we had this debate and instituted this not many years ago, and now we want to change it after what I think is the first two challenges. And I don't understand why we would do that. But so either I want to hear from Historic Commission.
I would like to hear from the Historic Commission, too. I can just give them a call.
All right.
Or I don't know if John wants to come in Monday night.
Why don't you give him a call? If he can come in, great. We'll try to...
If not, then maybe he can just put something together and
He can talk to you, and I'd be glad to hear your report.
Okay.
So that would be 25 and 26 on hold.
Yep.
All right, so 27 and 28 are lined articles, and because I abut one or more of the properties on each of these, I need to recuse myself.
So this is going to be a 1-1-1 probably then.
I am glad to speak as a private citizen from the audience if you are willing to hear from me, but that isn't, you may not be willing to hear from me. In any event, just to be official, I am going to go sit in the audience. If I speak from the audience, it will be as a private citizen and not as a selectman.
Okay. To me, recently we talked about this, and we already, in my mind, as a board, we already put it to bed and said, no, we don't want to sell any land right now. And I don't know why we would agree to.
I don't have a problem with selling the land. There is one parcel that I would like to take off the list, and I don't know if that's possible or not, because I don't think you can modify the...
On the town meeting floor, you can amend the petition.
Yeah, because I just think there would...
Citizens, forgive me, permission to address the board. Citizens' petitions cannot be changed in any way.
They cannot be amended by the town meeting?
No. What was presented is what must be voted on.
Okay, I'm not going to... I know that's the way they have to go in the warrant, but I wasn't sure the town meeting didn't have the option to amend those things once they went in, because the town meeting generally is your legislative body for everything.
We with CPC went through this, and it was made absolutely clear that what's written is what has to be voted on.
Okay.
I mean, we can confirm that with...
Let's confirm it with Alana.
With Alana when she comes in, but that is my very clear understanding.
Which one would you...
Just the 16 acres. I mean, I think that would be used for a better purpose than just to sell it for homes. I mean, these smaller ones, something we talked about anyway, it ended up being such a pain in the neck trying to do this, where this is only... So how is this going to work? Are they just giving us the authorization to sell these, or no? It's actually to instruct the treasurer collector to sell these at auction, which I don't have a problem with it. I mean, we need the money. I just don't like that one parcel in there, because I think there would be better use for that than house lots. But we'll have to find out if we could amend that on town meeting floor.
If we could amend it, that would be one thing.
Why don't we hold that one till we find out? Do you want to hold it until we find out from Alana?
But we'll have to vote Monday night.
So, yes.
So
possibly one of you might want to check with Alana about amending.
Do you want me to, or you to?
I don't care either.
Okay. Doesn't matter.
Dale could.
Yeah, do you want to contact Alana and see if we can amend
a citizen's
petition on town meeting floor?
If we can amend a citizen's petition.
Mm-hmm.
So we're holding 27? I'm not.
Yes.
I'm just the audience.
Yeah, we're holding 27 and 28. Do you want to come back up here now that we're done with all that?
May I address you, or should I just let it sit?
What do you mean?
Address the board about these two as a private citizen?
Sure.
Okay. The Board of Selectmen did look at these, and we recognized how complex, or the board recognized how complex some of this was, and we decided that it needed more study.
Mm-hmm.
My concern on citizens' petitions like this is just that we decided it needed more study, and then suddenly this is before us without more study. That's piece one. Piece two, just personally, I am adamantly against the sale of any town land that would be used for development, particularly residential development, albeit it adds to some tax revenue. I think many very bright authorities feel in the long run it's revenue negative.
Oh, absolutely. And, it's revenue negative. Anybody has got kids in the schools, it's negative.
So in the interest of the rural character of this town and in the interest of frugality with tax dollars, I think we need to look very closely as well.
You know, I'd like to hear from maybe Bob Carling, too. If these things are buildable, or not? And, I mean, can these be divided, or is this just going to be one property?
There may be some concern with the language on some of these. Again, I'm speaking as a private citizen. I have come to understand that the language on selling, on trying to limit this to two lots, that there is no legal way to do that. And I think we're going to have to hear from, or you all will have to hear from town council on that, but that may not be feasible in and of itself.
What do you mean limit it to two lots? What do you?
Article 28 is trying to limit the subsequent subdivision to two lots. My understanding through a very reputable land attorney is that there's no way to do that. Moreover, just as a reminder, the assessed values are probably highly open to question on these, because there's a lot of the stuff that isn't buildable.
Yeah, I mean, so that's it too, is, you know, which of these are even buildable lots, which these smaller ones probably aren't, because they don't even meet minimum lot size requirements for a house.
Yeah, so, you know, in theory, I wouldn't be against selling smaller things to abutters.
And this would make it easier for us, because it certainly was.
But the larger parcels, you know.
But if it could be amended on town meeting floor, then, okay. Dale, can you check with council on 28 to see if that language is enforceable about the two lots, if this can be subdivided into two lots?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
In other words, can it be deed restricted to the two lots, right?
Mm-hmm. Awesome. Thank you for doing that.
No problem.
Are you going to come back up here now, or are you going to stay up there? Absolutely.
Okay.
It's your chair.
I like it down there. This is.
Well, soon you'll be sitting out there.
I will be indeed. Okay, we're up to 29. So I think we'll probably have a divided vote on these, but so 29 is the. Vote on the.
This was the non-binding one that we knew right away was non-binding.
So I'm a little confused about this. Are they asking that it be put on the ballot 2 days after it passes? Or we have to have another election?
Which one are you talking about? 29?
29.
No, I think it's just voting at town meeting whether you support it or not. I think that's what it is. But that's the way it was written, so.
Yes, the way it's written, I don't.
I think it's just, it's a non-binding vote. In other words, it's
just to show up
right there
hands.
That night.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Alana said it was a non-binding vote.
Yeah, just a show of hands. That's all it is.
So I'm going to vote against this one.
I'm going to vote for it.
Well, like Mark, I'm a little uncomfortable about the precedent it sets, but I also think that voters have a right to have a say, and I'll vote for it.
Is that a yes or a no?
That was a yes.
Okay.
Sorry.
So it's a 2-1, or a 1-2.
Okay. So.
And it's non-binding.
And you're right, it is non-binding.
And, you know, I mean, it may be to clarify that what those that are voting for it are voting for is to allow the vote.
That's how I read it. And I don't see how we could put it on the election in 3 days, and I don't see why we want the expense of another election.
Yeah.
Okay.
No,
so
that comes up in 2 articles from now.
So 30 is instructing the selectmen to oppose, which is also very interesting on whether town meeting can instruct the selectmen to oppose.
So we don't know that answer, whether it's binding or not. It probably isn't, but
I think it isn't, which is one of the reasons I'll vote against it.
All right, I'm going to vote for it.
I'm going to vote against this. I don't. I'm going against it.
Okay, so this one is not recommended, then?
This is not recommended, 2-1.
All right. Next one is...
this is would require a vote.
Yeah, bylaw change.
The bylaw change.
That all RMDs should be put to a ballot vote prior to approval by the Board of Selectmen.
What I don't know on this one is I presume this is moving forward. I'm not sure you can change this halfway through when we have an application pending.
Oh,
no, that would
no
be grandfathered.
I think, yeah, that would be grandfathered in. This would be going forward.
So I'm against this one.
All right, I'm for. Geez, Colin, we always end up with you last.
Well,
I know. I should have waited for her to go, though.
Yeah, wait next time.
I know, wait.
So far, it's 1-1.
You want to think about it?
No, I'm against it.
Okay,
so we got another 2-1, not recommend.
All right.
Yep.
We're making progress here. So 32... Okay, so this is a big, long story. This sounds like it's asking tax money to be voted for this. This is an accounting thing. It's the vehicle to get the cable, the money from the Comcast cable license agreement to the studio.
Mm-hmm.
We have been dealing with this for 3 years. DOR, I'm sorry, folks, if any DORers out there are driving a stark raven crazy. They came out with a directive about 3 months
mm-hmm.
ago. I have been working for 5 months with town council on this. I received something today that I'm going to have to check on, but it looks like DOR has said okay and even admitted that it's all screwed up and that maybe they're just going to let things sit for another year.
Oh, good Lord.
Whatever we do, this will come up again next year. I can't stress enough that this is going to require a little education to the town meeting. They are not being asked to raise $55,000. In any event, I hope by Monday I'll have more clarification, or certainly by the time we meet with Alana, more clarification. But I urge us to vote in favor of this because this is the only way we're going to be able to have the money to keep
pay Comcast.
So, are we all in favor of that one?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. 33 is our clarification on the essentially what have been labeled step increases to get beyond a lot of confusion
mm-hmm.
and misunderstanding. I'm not absolutely sure I agree with it. I just want it to be clear, and I think it's actually a small amount of money that's involved. And I think in terms of townhouse morale, it's most important to just get this cleared up.
Well, yeah, and it controls the amount of increases, which makes it easier for Finance Committee to plan
yep.
rather than just have it be, you know, willy-nilly. So,
yep.
yeah, I support this one.
Yes.
Okay. 34 is...
mm-hmm.
the highway superintendent change.
Making it appointed rather than elected.
Yes.
Right.
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. 35 is our town administrator,
mm-hmm.
establishing our town administrator.
Yes.
I think we are all in favor of that.
Little typo there, Dale.
Where is it?
After July 1st. It's got you've got a period instead of a comma.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Colleen, you missed it.
All right.
It's been a long week.
She's off her game.
And 36 is our potential land purchase of abutting land to this property.
There and again, the way it's written, I may have to get a clarification because they have it as assessor's map and lot, and it's going to end up being a portion of that can be in the motion and the amount of money. Was it
when we talked last week? We said 60,000.
60. Okay. All right, I will update that if you guys want to approve it on
mm-hmm.
that basis.
I'm assuming they're negotiating. I
it appears so.
I me. I sent an email from Mexico.
One would hope.
Try and encourage that.
Aren't we like world travelers? You were sending emails from Mexico. I was sending emails from the northern mountains of Israel. Yeah.
Not me. I was just sending them to Plympton. It was in downtown Plympton.
All right.
So we didn't vote on that one.
Okay. I.
Okay. So this is the one for the public safety building
consultant.
I thought it was going to be a much higher number than that.
We did. We said 150,000.
Yes.
Or was it 160?
150.
It was 150, and then the one that was from last year, the 25,000, gets rolled
into that. A total of 175 or a total of 150?
Total of 150, so that would be 100.
Okay, so we will change that to...
125?
Oh, so that's probably just a typo.
It could have been. It could be.
Yeah. Have been that was what we first said. And
okay. So all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All right. 38 is...
What is this one?
What is this one?
That was the one that allows the Finance Committee a different time frame to present the capital plan to the Board of Selectmen. Yeah.
It was way too early.
It was too hard for them
okay.
to do it now.
Aye. Aye, aye.
Aye.
Okay.
This is the
video camera?
Mm-hmm. Video cameras for Dennett.
Why do they need them? Is there stuff happening?
It's a safety precaution. It's
okay.
all part of, sort of homeland security and everything else. This can be the system they want to put in. It can be remotely operated from police dispatch. Plus, it also gives anybody a working knowledge of what's going on anywhere in the building, which is really important.
Oh, at the school and fields. Okay, I missed the school. I thought this was just the fields. I'm like, well, geez, no. What's happening on the fields? Okay.
Three eyes?
Yeah.
Okay. 40 is just the usual,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay.
All right, you got a typo on that one too. Other. Any otter?
Yeah.
Okay.
And.
Hi.
41 is the electricity aggregation.
Ooh, yes, which can be a cost savings. That's a good one.
We're probably going to have to, we'll talk about this when we get a little closer. This is probably going to take a little selling at town meeting just for people to understand that they can opt out, that they're going to save $60. And
it's not a huge savings, but every little bit helps.
No, it's just, as soon as you get into power purchase, it just gets so... Okay.
So do you want to talk at that one at town meeting?
Yeah.
Or did you want Eric to come in?
I think we're going to be good just talking.
Okay.
Just curious, do they have to actually opt out or do they opt in?
They have to opt out.
I believe they have to opt out.
It's an opt out
clause. Okay. And once you're out, you're out.
I thought you could get back in.
Mm-mm.
I don't remember. The thing that may save some time on this is it's the last one, and people...
Be like, oh,
and
my
it may
God,
be the last one of the second night.
Is
so.
This the order we're going in?
Unless we change it.
I think it's a good order.
Good enough for me. So
all right, do you want to vote on that one?
Aye.
Aye.
Sure.
Aye. Okay. Now, are we... Okay, so I think that's that. We are voting on the specials as well. Right?
Oh, yeah.
There you go. There's really not a whole heck of a lot on the specials.
Can you assure us that these are pretty straightforward things?
What's that?
There you go, Colin.
Thank you.
So Article
1 through 7, you mean?
1 through 3.
Oh, on the special.
On the special.
Yeah, 1 through 3, I'm not sure. They were going to use the money from Pembroke. FinCom is going to make the recommendation as to how much money they use out of that to transfer to the OPEB account. I don't know where the money's coming from for the TNT energy reimbursement, but that's the money so that we can pay them.
Finish up with the green communities?
Yeah, so that the state will give us, so that the state will give us our money.
Will give us the $35,991 back.
Exactly. And the last is to build up the building and grounds account. Again, we've used some of it this year, but that will build it up, you know, to a fairly reasonable number. I'm not even sure where it would
be. I'm sorry, which one is that?
Article 3.
Okay.
So that's for like septic, that's for all the maintenance that needs to be done around the building.
You know, I mean, if something breaks down or blows up, we're covered.
Or the roof leaks, God forbid.
It's not an insurance roof leak.
Okay.
And then 4 through 7 are the four pilot agreements for facilities by Borrego.
Now, is one of these on hold? Or was that conservation thing for something different?
That was the one at Tuxedo. Well, one was Brook Street and one was, it was two of them that there was some discussion.
Yeah, the Winnetuxet, I think they had that one, is on hold because they had a wetlands determination they have to do.
But we should know it by town meeting, right?
Yeah.
I would think so, but regardless, it just gives us the permission to do it, assuming they pass everything else that they
okay.
have
to do. Okay, okay.
You know, we couldn't override that. 1 through...
That's 7.
4 through...
Oh, I don't have 4 through 7
oh,
yet.
Oh, here. There you go, right there.
All right. That's...
It's the four pilot agreements.
It's, yeah.
Okay. So, good. I'm glad they're in there.
And we do... What would it get around 76... Do you remember what the figure that we would get?
You mean for all four of, for the four pilot agreements?
Yeah.
No, I don't remember.
I thought he gave us a figure.
I mean, it varies with each one because they're different size facilities. But
right. One of them was like $7,600 a year, or $76,000.
Seriously?
No, not 76,000.
No, I think it might have been 7,600 because the pilot agreement amount on the 5.4, the one that's built and up and operating, is I think 16,500.
Yeah.
A year annually.
And these are smaller.
And I think these probably would maybe total that, maybe might probably be a bit more than that.
Yeah, maybe he was giving a cumulative number, and I just misheard.
Okay, so are we okay on the four pilots then?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So, all unanimous.
Okay. So, actually,
now, do the assessors actually recommend the pilots?
Because it's a way of a method of paying taxes. Yes, technically, it comes from the assessor's office to recommend it in the form of a
warrant article.
Then
okay.
Does the board of assessors
have to speak
have
to them?
To speak to it?
I would. Yeah. I mean, you know, in this case, they would probably speak in general terms. We tried to do 2 1 year, and you couldn't get 2 through in 1 year. I don't know what's going to be like for 4, but anyway. And essentially, the bottom line by way of explanation is the facility is worth X amount of dollars to construct. Let's use a round number of $10 million. And it because it's a commercial property, it depreciates over a period of continuously, but by 20 years, you depreciate it out for 20 years. So if you weren't to get the pilot, you would get a mega amount of money in the early years and a minuscule amount of money in the later years. They like to do pilots because it levels it out for their investors. And at the end of the day, it's the same amount of money coming into the town, except it's stretched over 20 years rather than being front-loaded.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. And that's the easiest way to explain it to people so they understand. It's not like nobody's getting a discount.
So just to finish up on town meeting warrant articles, obviously we'll have more to discuss with FinCom Monday night. This goes to the printer Tuesday, so it's our last shot at it. The week after that, Ilana will come in. That'll be our time for questions. Town moderator will be here. Town accountant will be here. Yeah. That's essentially our dress rehearsal to get everything pinned down so we can sit before... the public and run this whole thing smoothly.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
That will be a busy week because on the 2nd we've got
Collins
Group coming in to talk about the financial forecast. And
just like Joe Freda said, 24/7, 24/7 job.
And on the 7th I have a spring tea for 75 people.
You have what?
A spring tea for 75 people.
Oh, wow.
A spring tea.
It's a nice round number.
With little cups and saucers.
Yes.
On what day?
The 7th.
The 7th.
Saturday.
Okay.
Where's that?
At the church.
Wow.
I heard back from Monica Lamboy and about the Economic Development Committee that we were talking about last time, and she said she had never set one up. Well, she said, I don't know that much about it, but we had helped this Adams, I believe, create one. And she gave me the name of the town coordinator there. So she said, you know, I'll help you. I said, why don't I just call him? So I'll call the town manager or coordinator from Adams and see what they've got on the Economic Development Committee.
Just out of curiosity, since this other project of urban renewal has come up, would this committee also help us work against inappropriate things or just?
Possibly. I want to reach out to Old Colony Planning Council and have them help us with this too, with the urban renewal.
I think we said this last time. The economic development thing in the long run is the most important thing. I mean, it's the thing we're not spending time on yet. In the long run, it's more important than all the rest of this combined.
Yeah, I mean, we need to work towards our financial future. I mean, we've made big strides already with what we're doing with the Collins Group, and this will just continue the good work.
So let's see if we can wrap up pretty quickly here. Since we were on solar, any other solar issues?
Negotiations are in process. Dale received the information on the pilots from Zach. You got everything you need, Frank.
Yeah, that's how I wrote the warrants.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right. Probably we've covered everything Dale's been working on, but anything else you want to add?
The only thing I want to add is that I did a contact with Halifax.
Oh, okay.
And she's getting back in touch with me, and I will put her in touch with you. So we're good to go. There is some interest there.
Thank you.
And Halifax is interested in not making it a intermunicipal agreement.
Right.
They would rather we do a private agreement just like that. So that makes it even easier.
Thank you, sir, okay. Very much.
You're welcome. I'll forward all the stuff to you when I get it.
Awesome.
There's a message in for it.
Awesome.
And other than that, it's been all warrants all the time for me.
Correspondence.
All warrants every day. Okay. All right.
In addition to regular stuff.
From Triad, 10-year anniversary, Wednesday, May 18th, 12 noon at the Woodlands. If anyone is able to attend, the guest of honor is Secretary of Elder Affairs, Alice Bonner. RSVP required. I have to work, so I won't be able to go, but I don't know if either one of you can go.
Wednesday the 18th. That's town meeting day.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
Probably
not a good day for me either.
Okay.
I'll hand that back to you.
Thank you. Okay, so we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 letters in support of the indoor medical marijuana facility. It looks like these are from the Zioli family on Blanchard Drive. And not sure this first name, Weirman on Tall Timbers, but everybody else was Zioli. Yep. Okay. Security issue?
Oh, that's the keys.
Yeah.
We probably need to talk about that when Bree is.
Want to hold it till Monday?
Yeah.
Okay, so we'll hold that till Monday.
But let's hold it in correspondence so it can be introduced.
Perfect. Okay. Oh, Joe Freitas is highlighted. He still has.
The piece, well, we'll go over it Monday. We did change the lock on her entry door, on her closet door, for security reasons. And at some point, we have to address the bigger issue, maybe, of all the keys that are out to this building itself.
We rekeyed the building.
That may.
3 years ago, rekeyed the front door, the exit, 3 years ago. And after a time, because. I mean, it's the policy of Plympton to allow every board and every committee, and sometimes even on beyond that, to pass out keys. So it gets it, key control gets to be a bit tricky.
You know, so
maybe this may not, maybe we won't get to it Monday. I think at a future agenda it should get on, but I'm not sure that Monday we aren't pretty busy.
We are busy.
So we won't, we'll get that on the parking lot.
Okay.
You could put in a biometrics entry system, you know, with your thumbprint. That way there it knows who came in, when, what time, and all of that.
Yeah, I'm sure that wouldn't cost much.
What?
That wouldn't cost much.
Actually, well, no. I mean, they have biometrics that it's on a laptop. I mean, yeah. Laptops aren't that much.
Well, I wonder if even like a key code that you could change like every couple of months.
You could do that as well.
Yeah,
I mean, the thing is to be able to
say,
pull
just to be able to pull people off
instead of going to Aubuchon's and getting, you know, 25 keys made, or calling up somebody and say, return the key. It's kind of archaic, you know, when you think about it. It would be a lot easier to just put that kind of a lock on the door. The lock would be expensive, not the biometrics part of it.
Mm-hmm.
That's
interesting.
Anyway,
so that would go under our new buildings and grounds.
I don't want them to have my fingerprints. I got enough trouble.
Want to put your little eye in the thing? Okay, moving on. From Tara, it says, hi, just putting this on your radar, but it looks like Dean from Borrego will be contacting Amy directly about the continuation for the hearing, the CONCOM hearing on the pilot.
Yeah.
Okay.
There was a wetlands issue there, and again, that's a CONCOM issue. And
okay. Okay, from Bill Hayes, to whom it may concern, I will be unavailable as tree warden from Friday 4:15 through Sunday night 4:24. So this week he's been out. Barnes Tree out of Rochester, Mass. Is available if there is an emergent tree call that is more involved. Okay, so, but it looks like Highway's aware, so if there was an issue that they would have taken care of it. So do you have this? Do you want this in case you need?
Yeah, I'll just give it to
you. Have an issue? Okay.
I don't know. It's probably,
at this point, probably not. I think we're going to have some decent weather the next couple of days. Okay, this one is from Sharon Housley. It says, hi, I would like to request that all town personnel use email addresses at thetown.plympton.ma.us. The use of personal email addresses may be fine when things are going well, but when things become contentious, and a resident files a FO, Freedom of Information Act request for the emails because of concerns they have, it's very disconcerting to know that town personnel use private email addresses for official business that is not archived by or under control of the town. As a taxpayer and resident of the town, I think all public officials should be transparent in their dealings, and I think this would be a step in the right direction. Thank you, Sharon Housley. And we are supposed to be using our email addresses.
That's what we're moving toward.
We're moving towards.
And it will perhaps be easier when we have a new system if we get that grant.
Hopefully
the server.
We get that grant. Have you heard anything?
No, I was supposed to contact Pam Coker, and I will do that.
Kind of tweak it and ask what's going on about the grant, but I mean, we're just curious.
I know, but she reached out to us.
My guess is they'll probably be rewarding it sometime when they're started to turn out their research. I'm guessing July or something.
Okay.
Like that.
I'll shoot her an email.
Yeah.
And let you know what she says.
Yeah, because that would be really great.
That would be really great.
Yeah.
Okay.
Worked out for Hillary Clinton.
All right. Let's see. All right, this was Sharon's Freedom of Information request that you talked about earlier. So you already talked about it.
15.5x32 shirt size.
And we, you actually talked about it at our last meeting too, because you had received it then.
Aren't the pants isn't your pants like 10 inches?
Oh, dang! Oh, jeez. You caught me. Misinformation.
Yeah.
Actually,
right.
Usually the inseam's 8.
Okie dokie. This was the Plympton Halifax Express. Geez, he's not here to even enjoy this. All right. This was the article about testifying before the committee, which was, it was pretty interesting. And then we got a nice tour of the State House, which is beautiful. I'd never been there before, so it was really nice. It was. All right. Then talking about Brook Street. which, or the Brook House retreat. I wrote the letter. I didn't send it because I knew you weren't home, so I'll send you guys the letter that I drafted to those guys. And I think that was about it for Plympton. Did you find anything else?
Opening of the parks.
Oh, yeah. How did I miss that one? Okay. Opening for Plympton Parks will be Saturday, April 23rd. So that's this Saturday.
It is.
What time?
12 to 3.
12 to 3.
1 p.m. Sort of a ceremony.
Short ceremony.
At the gravel pit. Oh, there you go. Sorry.
At the gravel pit?
Yeah.
What, you mean that, like, that bowl in there?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's a better name, the bowl.
Yeah. Yeah.
Some state representatives should be here. There.
William Keating.
I don't know.
Invited
if Tom's
guests
coming.
Include the descendants of the Churchill family, Representative William Keating, the Wildlands Trust and Compact of Cape Cod Conservation Trust. Okay, very nice. And rain date is Sunday. So how? I mean, does it have to be pouring for you to call it? I don't think it's supposed to rain on Saturday, though, is it? I think it's supposed to rain a little bit tomorrow.
I think they were calling for showers. I would presume Plympton Parks and Plympton Helping Plympton would be the surest way to get information on that.
Awesome.
Hopefully we're a fairly hardy lot and we can get it done. We have a pretty beautiful park out there. It took about 5 years of work from a lot of citizens to get it done, but it's something we can truly be proud of, and people all over the South Shore and all over the state are pretty amazed at the cost effectiveness and the real beauty of what we put together. So come and celebrate. We have plenty of time to deal with complicated issues, and every once in a while we have a victory to celebrate, so please join us.
It is beautiful.
Please join us. Please join us.
Beautiful, beautiful.
Okay.
Okay, that's all we've got.
We do have some stuff on the parking lot. Maybe we can look at that Monday night. Next selectmen meetings, I think we're looking at probably every Monday until town meeting.
Okay.
Do you want to add 5-3 to that?
We do have 5-3 on there.
Oh, yeah, it is down below.
Yeah.
It's just not with the
5-2 is Collins Group. 5-3 is town council dress rehearsal.
The 18th for the town meeting.
Who what?
You have to add the 18th for the town meeting.
Oh, yeah.
Post one for the
all
town
right,
meeting.
So add town meeting date.
Mm-hmm.
We're behind on minutes, and so I think we have April 10th, 11th, and 13th, and now this one. So.
Mm-hmm.
And we have those minutes?
No.
No, we don't.
Okay.
And I think it is sooner or later, we'll get called on this, and I do still think as best we can, we're all a little overburdened, but we need to model behavior for the other boards, committees, and commissions in time and be a little more time sensitive on this.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, we're going to be back in 3 days. We have some homework to do in terms of the municipal host agreement. And
okay.
Any last words from anyone?
Did we sign this yet?
The motion was that we approved it and would assign it Monday night.
Okay, so it's going to be Monday night.
Yeah,
perfect.
It will not be on the agenda, but I think we're okay with the way we've done
it. Yeah, I mean, you already voted it, but we're going to have to scratch this thing about all trucks turning right. Okay.
All right, so do I hear a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
And actually, just before we actually do that, Dale had a vacation day, and he and I had to chat a little earlier in the day, and he's here tonight, and we appreciate that.
Oh, yeah, no problem.
Were off today?
Yeah, well, I have to burn vacation time because you guys won't let me carry
it
over.
We
and
won't.
I'd hate to tell you how much vacation time I have to burn between
you got a lot more
June.
Than I do.
And you got the right day there.
Huh?
You got the right day.
I just watched the calendar. Is the weather going to be good? Okay, I'll take today.
There you go.
Smart man.
All right, so we have a motion. I'll second it. All in favor of adjournment?
Aye.
We thank Area 58 and the videographer and the audience. Thank you very much.